So good morning to all. We start today's CME program on gynecologic obstetrics update, and today is the International Gynecology Oncology Day as well, and we have organized this CME. And Dr. Priya Ganesh Kumar, the chairperson elect of the Gynecology Committee of OCSI. She has helped us a lot to organize this program by getting faculty from all over the India who are famous internationally. And so today we have arranged a wonderful program covering most of the aspects of gynecology with a special emphasis on cervical cancer. And there is a wonderful tumor board panel discussion as well. So on behalf of the Perinthalmanna ONG Society, I welcome Priya Ganesh Kumar, the chairperson elect of FOCSI Oncology Committee
21-22.
Welcome to this webinar CME, and really thankful to you for helping us to organize this program. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you very much. And,
we have Dr. Ambujam, the president of Kerala Federation of Obstetrics and Gynecology, and the chief guest for today. And madam is actually in between the confidential review of maternal death meeting, and she has found some time to attend this program. And on behalf of the ONG Society of Perinthalmanna, I welcome you, ma'am, and request to inaugurate the program to be the chief guest as well, because I have not informed her just over this platform. I am just informing Margaret. So really sorry for that. And on behalf of the Perinthalmanna ONG Society, I welcome Dr. Fessy Lewis, the vice president elect of FOCSI. I welcome Dr. Ashok Kumar, and he has been a really good driving force for all our academic activities, being the national coordinator of FOCSI. And each CME, whenever he's participating, I would like to, I used to stress the point that he is the person who has inaugurated this society almost a year back. So welcome Dr. Ashok Kumar to this meeting. And we have a lot of faculty. We have Dr. Sandeep Mathur, the professor of pathology from All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Welcome, sir. Welcome to this meeting. We have Dr. Puneet Chandra, the precision oncologist from Delhi. And we have Dr. Manish Chandra, the oncologist from Mumbai. And we have Dr. Shalini Rajaram, the oncology professor from Delhi. And we have Dr. Adarsh. I can't see the Santosh here. I think he has disappeared. Once after we told him to uncheck the green screen, he has gone to the green field, I think. So welcome Dr. Santosh Kuriakos. He is the chairperson of the Oncology Committee of Kerala Federation, and also the associate professor at Calicut Medical College, and doing a lot of work of his COVID duty assignments. And welcome Dr. Adarsh Dharmarajan, the oncosurgeon from Talasheri. Welcome Dr. Adarsh. And we have Dr. Wahab, he is the secretary of our society. So on behalf of the society, I welcome all the guests, the faculty, and the delegates. So welcome you all. Now I request Professor Dr. Ambujam to kindly inaugurate the CME. Over to you, ma'am.
Respected President, Perinthalmanna Obstetrics and Gynecology Health Society, Secretary Dr. Wahab, the FOCSI officials and very energetic young team, Dr. Fessy and Dr. Ashwath, and Santosh Kuriakos, Chairperson of Oncology Committee of Kerala Federation. A very good morning to all of you, and I bring greetings from Kerala Federation. And you all are now battling against the epidemic of COVID-19. The cases are increasing day by day. And women's health, actually, we cannot defer many of the obstetric as well as gynecological illnesses in women. we have actually scaled down many of our services, like fertility procedures. Everything has been a little bit postponed, and also antenatal care also we have modified in a different way. But we have been continuing with prevention and management of malignancies in women. And I congratulate Perinthalmanna Obstetrics and Gynecological Society for this venture, because today is the Cancer Awareness Day. So it's very apt and relevant to keep such an update on this day. And we all know that however hard we have been trying to prevent malignancies, they are still on the increase. Especially cervical cancer, we need to concentrate more on screening procedures. So with this background, actually every year for the cancer awareness, all the societies of Kerala have been doing wonderful work by organizing awareness programs in the public, doing walkathon. So many activities, we all miss that. The only platform now we can see each other is this virtual platform, and we have to make use of it by sharing our knowledge and updating ourselves. I'm very happy to see many of the eminent faculty today talking on various aspects of oncology. And I wish all success to this conference, and I officially inaugurate the Gynecological Oncology Update Webinar CME of 20th September. Thank you very much. Jai Kepung.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the kind words. I request Dr. Ashwath Kumar to do the felicitation. Dr. Ashwath is the past National Vice President of FOCSI and the National Coordinator of FOCSI. Over to Dr. Ashwath. Audio.
Ashwath, please unmute.
I also would like to add that Dr. Ashwath Kumar is having the fellowship in oncology from Gujarat, and he is a famous oncosurgeon as well. And now he is working at Jubilee Mission Medical College Hospital at Thrissur. He is a famous teacher preparing the MBBS students for the NEET.
Hello. Now you can hear?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes, Ashwath. Yes.
Now we can hear. I am just okay. Good morning, everybody. First of all, I thank Dr. Kunjumaydeen, Dr. Wahab, the President and Secretary of POGS, Perinthalmanna Obstetrics Society, which is doing a wonderful work. And always, I am proud that I inaugurated society, and our oncology newly elected oncology chairperson, Dr. Priya Ganesh Kumar. We are going to have, definitely, madam, we are going to have next 3 years. It will be, your vision is so good that you will be doing excellent work. We will all support you for all the activities which you are doing. And we have so many, my teacher, Ambuja madam, and Faisi, my friend Faisi, and my friend Santosh, and with and all the esteemed faculty, many of them I am seeing for the first time, because all the great people, I know they are all in the field for many years. So very nice to have all of them in a single platform. And one thing I should tell you is personally is that when Kunjumaydeen told that it's a World Gynecology Day, I just went into the Go Day website actually. So you should be so surprised to see that only activity which is featured in the Go Day website today from Asia is the Perinthalmanna, this activity. So they have only, you can see the, you have to appreciate Kunjumaydeen. This activity is there in the website. I wanted to put a screenshot of that. Anyway, everybody should go and click. We will be very proud to say that it is there, featured 11. It's everywhere. So many people, I hope that will be seeing this in the world map itself. It's a big map. And India, Asia, it comes. There's a star which is blinkering now at 11 o'clock. So it looks very star. So Kunjumaydeen, excellent work. So you have been always doing an excellent work, and keep it up. And with KFOG, we are proud that Santosh also is there doing excellent work with all oncologic activities. So all our supporters with you, and all the best for today's program as well as all the programs which is in the oncology. And I am basically an oncology person only, so I always like to be in an oncology webinar always with the latest updates to know. Thank you so much for inviting once more Kunju Mohideen and Wahab for inviting me to this webinar. Thank you so much. All the best.
Thank you, Dr. Ashok, especially for the nice words regarding the gynecology awareness website. So actually, we have just applied for it and it was accepted two days back. And thank you, Dr. Ashok, for the nice words. Now over to Dr. Faisi Luis, and he's the vice president elect of FOXI. He's a very good friend of mine, and he's currently working as the consultant IVF specialist and associate professor at Amrita Institute of Fertility at Kochi. Over to Dr. Faisi.
Thanks for the introduction, Dr. Kunju Mohideen. It is nice to be back to an academic session by the Perinirmana ONG Society, which was very active as a club before and now official society. Even though I was supposed to go to for one meeting by the time that lockdown started. And I think Kunju Mohideen, as you all know, is very active academically and clinically. I know him since 1987, right from the Thrissur Medical College times. And also Abdul Wahab also, he's very active. And all the Perinirmana Society members, because when I was in Adapal, I was part of this Perinirmana, at that time it was known as Malappuram ONG Club. So I am still part of that group and involved in seeing their academic activities. And it is a wonderful initiative from the Perinirmana Society to rightly take this day of International Gynecologic Day, CME. And none other than Dr. Priya, who is very active academically and in the oncology field. And I think not all people can cherish their dream. She was very active with this specific goal of oncology, and she got elected as the committee, FOXI committee chairperson for the next 3 years. So even before that, she has started activity and still she is continuing it. And she's a good friend. She has got her connections in South India. Also, she's clinical work is varying from Mumbai to Delhi. So congratulations once again, Dr. Priya. And we will all be with you for your initiative. To all the Perinirmana Society members for continuing this academic initiatives. And I also like to thank Santosh for this excellent initiative. He's very active, even though, as we told, he's involved in COVID work in between. Also, that primary aim of oncology prevention, that is not being sidelined, because otherwise the people will be suffering from this oncologic disease. So that has been taken care by continuing this initiative about the oncology. So Santosh, thanks for this night's initiative and taking initiative to arrange a wonderful faculty here. I think we have from Delhi, oncologist Dr. Puneet is there, and my friend Dr. Shalini is there from Delhi. Also Dr. Manish is there from Mumbai, and Dr. Sandeep from New Delhi, and also Dr. Adarsh also is here. Even though these names are familiar, we have not much associated with oncology activities. So it is nice to be updating and on this oncology field. Without wasting time, I wish all the success for this oncologic webinar organized by Perinirmana ONG Societies along with Kerala Federation of Obstetrics and Gynecology. I think Ambuja Madam, even though she's busy with the CRMD, she has come here to inaugurate the same. And my friend Ashwath also is here, although he had dealing with all the fields of obstetrics and gynecology, but he has got a fellowship in oncology from a prestigious institute in Ahmedabad. So he can also give valuable suggestions here. Over to you, Dr. Kunjimoidi.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Fessi, for that nice words. Now, Dr. Naimani Devi has joined with us. Madam, request Madam to say a few words.
Okay, I didn't see her. That's why I could not tell her.
Madam, just join me.
Yeah, first of all, I apologize because I had an emergency and I had to go and sort it out in the hospital. So anyway, let me congratulate Dr. Kunjimaitin, Perinthalmanna Society and Dr. Abdul Wahab and that team for celebrating this Gynec-Oncology Day that is today. And we have with us Dr. Priya Ganesh, who I should say devoted the entire part of her career for towards the upliftment of women and preventing them for from invasive CA cervix. I really appreciate Dr. Priya's aim in spreading the knowledge and about prevention of cancer cervix among the public and her initiative to work with the government of India so that everybody in this country could be scanned and screened for cancer cervix. See, after all, it is the second largest incidence of cancer that is occurring in the women, next only to breast. But we know cancer cervix is a preventable one. That is the most important thing. See, if the woman is going to get cancer cervix, then 10 years before that onset of the disease, active disease, the woman will show some signs of cancer cervix, pre-invasive lesions, which can be very easily picked up by via or by routine, our pap smear examination. And the concept of inculcating this habit into all our gynecologists. Whenever a woman enters the cabin, it is the opportunity for each one of us to check for the breast and for the cervix, breast and the cervical cancer, which can be easily picked up by our routine examination. Then again, today the topics are very, very interesting. Like, apart from Priya's topic, the panel discussion on tumor board consensus, I think that is the order of the day. See, we should have a triad of this gynecologists along with the radiologists, radiotherapists, as well as the chemotherapists in conquering this deadly disease. So, tumor board is very, very essential so that everybody can give an input regarding that particular patient when it comes to the question of dispersion, and we can execute the best possible treatment that is available to that particular patient in that area. So I congratulate Dr. Kunjimaitin and the team and Dr. Ambujam Madam of Kerala Federation of OBGYN, Dr. Ashwath Kumar, who is the national coordinator of FOXI, for being here today, and Dr. Fessy Lewis, who is going to be the incoming vice president of FOXI. I wish the program should go ahead it should spread the knowledge regarding gynecology to every attending physician. Thanks for the opportunity given to me. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Before moving on to the final program, we'll have a few words from the Dr. Santosh Kariakos, who is the chairperson of the Oncology Committee of Kerala Federation. Dr. Santosh, over to you for just a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Kunjimaitin. With the onset of this COVID pandemic, the whole emphasis on cancer prevention, especially the elimination of cervical cancer, has actually been sidelined. So I was very happy to see Dr. Priya Ganesh when she is delivering this keynote address, that we have to revitalize and make this momentum alive at this dark moments. Because it is very important that people do not lose focus, because pandemics come, pandemics go, epidemics come, epidemics go. But cancer is going to be there. So we have to keep this alive, this momentum alive, especially among member committees, especially among gynecologists. So I actually very happy to hear, to be part of this venture actually. Thank you very much for this and inviting me for this venture. Thank you. Dr. Kunjimaitin, your interest, even being an infertologist, a renowned infertologist, your interest in oncology is really amazing.
Thank you, Dr. Santosh, for that nice words. I invite Dr. Wahab to express the vote of thanks. With that, we'll conclude the inaugural program. Wahab? Dr. Wahab? So with that, we will conclude our inaugural program, and we'll have the vote of thanks at the end of the full academic session. So the first part of the today's program is the lecture keynote address by Dr. Priya Ganesh regarding the cervical cancer and the Mission 2030. So I would like to show her CV. Madam is the chairperson elect of FOCSI Gynecologic Oncology Committee 21-23, and she's also the medical director of Sai Niwas Healthcare. And Madam has done a lot of work on the cervical screening colposcopy workshops, and has a lot of publications, national and international journals, and the key orator and a good teacher. So over to ma'am for this lecture on the cervical cancer and the Mission 2030. Please share your screen.
So thank you very much. At the outset, let me congratulate Perinthalam Anna Society and Dr. Kunni Mohideen. You have really taken up this topic and on the right day of Gynae Oncology Day. And I congratulate that you are now projected onto the D-Day, what Dr. Ashwath was just saying, go day, there your program, is this program is being telecasted. So I'm truly very happy that you have taken this a step up to project gynae oncology in a better perspective. And yes, thank you very much, Dr. Ambujam, madam. The president of KFOG. It is a very active federation. Kerala societies are really taking up all the activities in a fantastic manner. Madam Ramni Devi, madam, is there, vice president of FOCSI of this year. We have Dr. Ashwath, past vice president of FOCSI. We have with us my great friend, Dr. Fessy, who is the vice president elect for the next year. And we have all the eminent speakers and eminent faculties with us. So when Dr. Kunni Mohideen had, gave me a call and he said, madam, this is the day and I want you to arrange a program for our POGS society and along with KFOG, I was highly excited. And I said, what better can it be when we culminate, you know, we collaborate the preventive path and then we take up the tumor board, and that's how the tumor board concept came up. And then having all my dear friends in the tumor board, it is great to see all my dear friends in the tumor board, and I'm quite happy it's going to be one of the icing on the cake when we culminate this program. So namaskar from my end, and this is, I bring greetings from Sai Niwas Healthcare. So I'm starting my deliberation with this this picture of Jade Goody, who unfortunately we lost her due to cervical cancer. It's not that this, we are getting some elite pictures over here projecting cancer. It is for the fact that she hailed from UK, and NHM has got a system of, NHS has got a system of call recall, and it boasts of its fantastic system. And every UID, every lady with her unique ID in UK is, you know, tapped with this NHS program of cancer screening. So this is how exactly the countries like Australia, the countries like UK are projecting in the global scenario. And suppose if a lady defaults, they get another call and there's a two defaults, and then her unique ID is, UID is defaulted or it is removed. Now, in such scenario, this is where we have to have an introspection of where we do stand in India. Why are we still leading the globe saying that we are the top in cervical cancers? So something which we have to introspect, and that's exactly what we will be doing. I'm very happy Dr. Ashwa, Dr. Fessy all have shown their commitment to, you know, help us together raise this issue in FOCSI as well, because FOCSI again is a body of 45,000 to 50,000 gynecologists, strong gynecologist team of the country. If you all can come together and work for this, I think we would not have this scenario coming up of cervical cancer peeping out and saying, you know me, but we have to have our whole community working towards this, which is around 12 to 15 times more than a cancer. So the pre-cancerous condition is where we have to all work together, which goes with all screening, and it is completely collaborating with the mission of 2030, which has now come up in the, why are we talking so much in India? Because one out of four lady who is dying of cervical cancer is an Indian. We just cannot have this taken, you know, we cannot digest this fact. And you can see this annual for global figures, a global figures projection, 810,000 women will have the cervical cancer. This is a projection. And the deaths would be 475,500 women will die due to cervical cancer, projection of 2030. What's the Indian stats saying? What's the latest Globocan stats of 2018 saying? Is 96,922 new cases annually, out of which, the deaths are 60,078. Now, we have definitely reduced what we were initially talking of, 72,000 came up to 69,000. Now it is projecting to 60,078. So that's again a good news to us. It's not that we are increasing, but yes, still it is second most cancer. And most, you know, the dismal part of it is one death of due to cervical cancer every 8 minutes. And daily we are losing 200 women out of cervical cancer. This is absolutely something which is preventable. So knowing the fact that cervical cancer, the cause of it is an HPV virus, for which Harald Zurhusen, he won the Nobel Prize in 2008. And he came up with a postulate, and we knew that that postulate was an excellent postulate, which has then framed up screening guidelines from there. And HPV, the persistence of HPV is the root cause for cervical cancer, almost 99.9%, and then only little bit of, you know, 0.3% of the cases which are not non-HPV types. So, but the maximum brunt is caused because of HPV high-risk viruses. And knowing all this fact very well, we know that HPV infection is not only for cervical cancer, it's put up at 100%. It is also related to various other cancers, like you can see vaginal cancer, vulval cancer, genital warts, anal cancers, oropharyngeal cancers, penile cancers. So knowing all these, this is a scientific evidence, and which is then to be taken up into our practice of how we can have, can it be possible that we can really put up ourselves as an Indian perspective into the global mission? Can we do something? That's a question which has been asked today globally, because yesterday when we had a wonderful a panel discussion with stalwarts like Dr. Shankar and Dr. Partha, we were the same thing. We were discussing, can an Indian perspective change this Indian scenario? So what are the perspectives which we should be having as a change in our mentality as well, and then going joining hands with government and doing certain programs? So yes, what we see is it possible? Yes, the answer is yes. And educating and empowering women to prioritize their health, and informing and educating the families on so proactive screening, all these things are definitely required. Because knowing this fact that cancer has got a huge 10 years, you know, to actually present, where we have knowing the fact that HPV, 80% of the women of the reproductive age group are susceptible to get HPV infection. So we have a primary prevention even before the sexual debut, you know, before even 15 years, we are giving a primary prevention by vaccination. And then the secondary prevention, because vaccination is the first pillar, then the second pillar goes is with screening. And definitely, yes, the screening has got its various arms and various tools, whereby we understand certain dysplastic understanding of intraepithelial neoplasias. We find them, we actually, because they are symptomless. The basic thing is they're symptomless. But yes, it's a good news to us that nature is giving us 10 to 15 years to work on, so that we identify and rectify by certain conservative procedures, so that we do not end up into this cancer. So knowing, so that is what we are talking about, is cervical intraepithelial neoplasia can be understood. This is a pathological term with 1/3, 2/3, and 3/3, and then knowing this, nowadays we are talking about L-cell and H-cell. L-cell goes with SYN1 and H-cell goes with SYN2 and SYN3 further with cancer. Now, development of CA cervix can be, as we have just said, whenever we have a transient infection. HPV is actually a transient infection. And it's only the persistence of HPV where is going to have certain problems. And so now when you have tell about a transient infection, it can be detected on the cytology. It can be also detected by HPV testing. Nevertheless, so now the basic structure which a global platform is seeing is primary HPV screening. And if we can get that concept built into our Indian scenario, I do understand there are various limitations and challenges to get that into a primary HPV screening in our Indian scenario. We can talk about a low resource setting. We will be telling about, you know, so many things. I'm telling you, it's a big chapter when we say about limitations and challenges, how we are not able to get it. But yes, we do have to have a mental framework and inhibition removed from even the healthcare providers' mentality. So then that's how we echo together. The voice goes strong. Government understands. Government definitely is understanding, not that it is not. I am working in very close quarters with government. It is also understanding the fact that, yes, we have to switch on from our VIA, which is observer specific, to a more robust method of getting a screening done. So that's with HPV, if you understand that. And then most of the cases clears up. It's only the progression. It's only the persistence which leads to precancerous conditions, which is then understood by colposcopy and the biopsy with it. And then that's how we understand this thing. So we have, you can see this whole set of 10 to 15 years for working for getting the cervical cancer down. So that's exactly what we do and what we are now echoing. This is the 73rd World Health Assembly decision. These are the latest decisions which they have taken up. It is on May we had this World Health Assembly. It's a written silence procedure, and the proposal relates to there are plenty of arms where they are working. In that one arm is definitely cervical cancer prevention and control. So talking on that, what is the strategy which has been designed for cervical cancer prevention? First of all, that there is a declaration that cervical cancer is a public health problem. So now that is something which is really a main thing to be looked upon as a public health problem by all the organizations, including India, by all the countries. And I'm sure there are plenty of countries who have really started working on this lines. Thailand, you can say small countries, they have put up their focus efforts on getting this public health program down. It's now India's chance to showcase what we do, what we have come up with, how they have adopted, what are the strategies adopted for this in 2020, 2030, 10 years, a decade just flies. We have to understand this, time is clicking. Only thing is when we can together come up, like organizations like FOCSI, AOGEN, ISSCP, all the organizations working towards the cancer prevention, they collaborate, echo together. And of course, we are all echoing together. When we collaborate and go with the health, the government of India and all the stakeholders starts now talking and taking up a decision of how should we progress ahead, I think it's going to be a dawn for India when we are really going to see the cervical cancer elimination, at least to some extent. Now, prevention through, so the three pillars what we are working through will be the prevention through HPV vaccination, screening and treatment of precancerous lesions and management of the invasive cancers, including the palliative care. So now what's the 90-70-90 target to eliminate cancer by 2030? So the strategies which has been pulled up and which has been jotted down and penned down, and now they're going to work on the micro strategies of how to actually start implementing this in our country. The strategies goes as 90% of the girls to be fully vaccinated by the age 15 years of age, at least 70% of coverage of screening. Now, can I, I would like to now say, what exactly is the screening percentage coverage in our country? And you all will be surprised, my dear friends, it is just 3% to 5%, that's all. And it's all built screening. There is no focused screening programs. And that's something which we'll have to again work on it. We all have to echo one voice. And it cannot be now put up. Of course, yes, cafeteria approach is there, but somewhere there has to be a proper streamlining and a guidance to be followed of how we can go ahead. So 70% of the coverage of screening with a high performance test, and that's something which I am time and again focusing, and I'm time and again telling this, is let's all do a high performance test, a biomolecular test, if an HPV can be done. You know, they're also saying that once in 35 years and once in 45 years, that's enough. Of course, our DCPR guidelines and all the AOGN guidelines, ASSCP guidelines, everyone are saying 5 a yearly, but still, if you want to have a strategy in place to eliminate cancer by 2030, we go to the bare minimum, looking at our resource setting, which is a low resource setting. Now, so, you know, in 10 years, once at 35, once at 45, should do wonders. And 90% of the women identified as either precancerous or cancerous goes for case management. And what do we understand by elimination? Let's again put up, it's not that you eliminate bolega to, it's all gone. No, you can't wipe out. You have to understand this, because there are certain percentage, about 0.3%, which is non-HPV types for cancer. So what they say is, if the incidences are reduced or maintained below 4 per 1 lakh population, that would reverberate or echo elimination. And that's a fantastic, it is actually a goal which we sometimes take it with a pinch of salt in our country. Can we do it? Of course, yes, we can. We have to try for it. So by 2030, cervical cancer incidences rate will fall by 10%. That's again a great thing. And this will actually avert 70 million cases in the country. So that's something which we all have to work together. And elimination and eradication, there are two different terms. When we talk about elimination, it is we continue all the intervention to eliminate the disease in the population or in the generation. Whereas when we talk about eradication, all the interventions are stopped. And no cases are reported, like, you know, we can say of smallpox eradication, but this becomes too much of asking. But here, yes, elimination is something which we can think about. So we have this FIGO CCCC4C, that is Comprehensive Approach to Cervical Cancer Control. And we do have the set of guidelines by FOCSI ICOG, National Health System, to support vaccination and screening, improve on the referral management, strong disease management, including palliation, and upgrade the National Cancer Registry. This is, again, a very important thing. And I think joint collaboration from all the societies and all the stakeholders and the leaders of FOCSI, we should be able to, you know, join hands to do this. Now, this is the 8 standardized incidences rate, or the current status where we are. This is in 2008, India was 27. 2012, it became 21.9, and then 2018, I'm happy it has reduced to 14.7. And if you talk about the mortality conditions and status quo, status of Globacon, 8 standardized mortality current status, 2008 is 18 for India. I'm talking of pertinently on India, Indian figures, and 2012 on 12.4, and this is, again, the mortality is reduced better. So thanks to the efforts taken up by various organizations, and thanks to all the sensitization which we have slowly started, you know, developing all the, so all this has really shown. But yes, if you see this scenario, we are on the higher side. Again, go back, if you see on this scenario, we are on the higher side. So we have to do a lot of work to catch up with this global status. And we have already spoken about this, and we have definitely highlighted on what is the cervical cancer burden, and these are all the arms which I have now shown up over here. and Sustainable Developmental Goals, which is SDG 2030, mortality from cervical cancer to reduce by 30%. Now let's see the current status of cervical cancer incidences in India. High are in Karnataka, Chhattisgarh, and Madhya Pradesh. Very happy today I'm sitting with Kerala Federation, and you see Kerala is low, 9.9, Goa is 7.9, and Jammu Kashmir is 7.6. So this is certain things, and I know Kerala Federation, all the leaders who have now pledged to help the mission, with all your supports, we would be definitely ready reducing this down as well, and also get the status reduced for Indian. So now my question again goes back is, will India be cervical cancer free? Or are we asking for too much? So the estimates, which are the first of their kind at the global scale, indicates that up to 13.4 million cases would be prevented within 50 years. And if the interventional strategies are scaled up by 2020, which we are already now today, but now we are going to talk about an extension of this 2020 to 2030. So without expanding our current prevalent prevention programs, a study predicts that 44.4 million of cervical cancer cases would be diagnosed over the next 50 years. So you can imagine that's something which is not taken. You know, we all have to work towards it. Raising from 600,000 women in 2020 to 1.4 million in 2030. So we have this position papers. We have various, WHO guidance notes of how we can take this up. It's a political declaration which they have done at the General Assembly level. And then when we talk about the first pillar, what are the challenges at HPV vaccination? We are talking so much of elimination should be done. Now let's now crystallize ourselves and go micro to each strategy. We have this as a vaccination. What are the barriers? Now, I'm not going to talk about how do you do a vaccine. We have heard enough of webinars. We have heard enough of if studied and read, but now I'm going to talk about the barriers. So this is something which has to be the inhibitions coming out. So barriers among the healthcare providers, what are they saying? Oh, this is not my age group. It's a pediatric domain. Now the screening is enough for preventing cervical cancer. Why am I doing a vaccination? Counseling patients for HPV vaccination is difficult. I am an infertility specialist. I am a sonologist, or I'm a laparoscopist. I'm a busy gynae. Now, I do not have time for counseling for an HPV vaccination, that too. Do I need to vaccinate if my patient is already positive? This is again a question asked n number of times in plenty of conferences and webinars. Now, the barrier amongst the patients, let's understand what patients thinks about it, or this is a proper study done, and that's how I brought this. My daughter is yet not now sexually active, so should you vaccinate her? Should I say cancer? And when you talk about HPV, you Google and you get the Google guru talking about it is a sexually transmitted infection. So the moment that strikes up, then the novelty factor and the promiscuity, all that comes up, And then people say, oh no, my daughter is not that type. Now another feature, I am too old for vaccination, forget it. I'm worried about safety. I cannot ask my daughter to get vaccinated. I'm a breastfeeding mother. Oh, can it be safe for me and my baby? And will the protection last for a longer time? I'm going to give my daughter at 11 years. And what are you talking, doc? And I think HPV vaccine is costly. So these are the barriers. But you can see over here, costly has come in the last line. So let's see how you can effectively address these barriers. So the challenges is when you are talking about, opportunities, we are the people who get the maximum opportunities. So you can see over here, opportunities during the delivery strategies. You can go to the girls. We have been invited by various schools and various colleges. Talk about it. Have a wonderful communication, impactful messages. You also have to involve males. The fathers are very dear to the daughters and they are ever ready to do anything for their daughters. So tell them, involve them, tell to them that this is a good gift which you're going to your child. Talk to the elderly people, talk to their mothers and teachers, talk to and affordability, it is not that high a thing. And what is it is post-introduction evaluation of the national programs is very, very important. Who will vaccinate? It has to be vaccinated. you can have this, because we have plenty of opportunities to have a lady come up into our OPD. So counseling for immunization can be taken up as one of the strategies wherever we are getting the opportunity to talk to our lady. Now, is screening required even if the vaccination is being done? You can see over here. Now, this is the paper. This is the reference which I brought for you. This is stating that the cervical cancer screening coverage is merely 3.1%. Now, that's dismal. And now, whenever it is dismal, and when you are going to have only screening, you can see this percentage. And if you have vaccination, you can see vaccination along followed by screening, you can see how the rates have increased. And vaccination alone is only over here. So that's again a news to us. And counseling for HPV vaccination is time consuming. Oh no, it's not time consuming. Have an impactful counseling, a small IEC materials projected, and that's one of the things which I'm going to take it up after taking up the chair. Let's see how FOXI can get certain impactful methodologies of improving our counseling status as well. So these are the messages which we can get it up. And do I have to vaccinate? She's positive also. Of course, yes. So this is a wonderful data which has come up, and then you know that it is from different, that is why it is not only the four types is what we are going to, solve out when we give a quadrivalent, or two types which we are giving the bivalent. Understanding the phenotype, 16 matches with 33 and 18 matches up with 45. Whenever we are going to give a vaccination, definitely we are also going to take up that well as well. But you have plenty of other 150 strains, so definitely screening has to be done. My daughter is too young. Now let's see what our patients have to tell. This was for healthcare providers. Let's say what our patients have to say. Vaccinations are prevention, not for treatment. So all these things are spoken. Higher, we have to say it's a higher immunity response for adolescents. This is a wonderful, chart which I have brought. You can see the immunity response in the adolescent is naturally quite high. And this is what we have to emphasize when we are talking about giving a vaccination at the early age. Immunizing before the exposure can give highest possibility efficacy. And so we have 98% efficacy in preventing cervical cancer, precancerous conditions caused by 16-18. And 100% efficacy when we are going to prevent a vulvar and vaginal precancerous and genital warts as well. Now, promiscuous behavior. I have only one partner, so I'm not very interested. And I'm not of that type. People always try to put up themselves in a policing, social policing. So now the study included over here, you can see enrolled for 3 months. This was a study which showed that yes, it has you will have to give a cumulative incidence as shown. That 30% were positive after 1 year and 50% were positive even after 3 years having one partner. So we will have to emphasize this fact, and we will have to get certain cartoon types or animation types when we are making an IEC material for our FOXIs as well. So cost of the immunization is less. When, of course, that again, the cost factor, when we give only two doses prior to 15 years, we give two doses 6 months apart. And later on, if the catch-up vaccination, we give three doses. I'm too old. No, never. It's not an old thing. We know that captures a vaccination, WHO said, was till 26 years. And then it came up with an extended immunization program till 45, which is also supported now by our GCPR FOXI as well. So I'm worried about the safety of the HPV vaccination. All the trials, which is the Futura trials, which has been there. Now we are on the phase 3 trials, which has pledged for, and it has proven beyond doubt that it's a safe vaccine. And these are the various agencies which are endorsing HPV vaccination. It is safe for breast, feeding women. Of course it is, it's not a live vaccine. And so it's just a VLP, it's a vaccine-like particles. And all the clinical data relevant to this has proven that it is safe in for a breast feeding women. So in the lactational, all these statutory bodies, international organizations are supporting with their guidelines for vaccinating a woman. They can take it up in the postpartum phase. So, and she doesn't have to go for an MTP, but inadvertently, if she has taken a dose and she finds that she's become pregnant, she can continue the pregnancy, no need to do an MTP, and she can take up the next dose while she is feeding. I mean, during a second or third PNC phase. Now, patients have read about effectiveness. It is, yes, this is a 100% effective even after 14 years of vaccination. So this is again the endpoint which they had seen when they did the study, and they have found a good effectiveness. And talking about the cost, the national survey says that, you know, the cost factor was more with the healthcare providers. It was the physician, this is a Canadian physician's, this thing they said, it was a healthcare provider's perspective that it is costly. Once we are the patients, when we say this is important, they don't see money, because we have been telling patients so many things and they are adopting to whatever we are saying. So that's something that the physician felt that it is high. So the cost barrier is more with the physician perspective, not than a patient's perspective. So effective HPV vaccination counseling and strong recommendations can definitely help to prevent the cancer. Secondary prevention is when we talk about the screening part, we have different modes. We have screen and treat, current options, on-spot treatment with ablatives, that's the screen and treat. We can do it with VIA. Sequential testing is carrying out a second screening method for the screen positives if precancerous conditions are found. And then we take it up in a colposcopy unit, they take a biopsy, and then also you can do it. So here when there is a screen and treat and you get a VIA positive or a PAP positive, she goes to a colposcopy unit where they do a C and treat, and there also you can treat it. So we can have a single visit approach or a multiple approach. We have this low resource setting, high resource setting, you can do by VIA. That is a complete, you know, a la carte. I mean, it's not an a la carte. In fact, it's a cafeteria. It's a complete thing, buffet, which has been given to us, that VIA, VILI, or you have an HPV DNA, you triage it with cytology, or you do a core test or something like that. And there are other things. Now, what are the barriers? Barriers can be lot of barriers. Now we have our screening guidelines, which are set up by Government of India, VIA. When you start it with 30 years, do it every 5 years. And when to stop at 65 years. And post hysterectomy screening need not be done if the pathology is not a CIN. And the preferable test of cure is HPV DNA along with a thing. So this is something, again, I wanted to show you that we stop it at 65 years. But if suppose if a lady hasn't done it even at 65 years, one time is okay. You do that by, you know, the best thing which we can do is by doing HPV DNA and you know, if it's not available, then at least a PAP test should be taken. And if suppose the screening has been, you know, abnormal and you've treated it by whatever methods, then at least post follow-up should be for 20 years. Then this is already, I had highlighted about screen and treat. And these are the intervals, VIA 5 years, cytology 3 years, HPV 5 yearly. And if you talk about immunocompromised lady with HIV, it cannot exceed more than 3 years. We also have our GCPR guidelines. It's all on the net. So I'm not going to take it up. Even if we're all stressing on HPV testing, we can positive, you triage it with any of these methods and go forward. You can do a VIA, you can do a cytology or do a genotyping, and then you can take it up. If it is a core test, which we do with HPV test and cytology together, we have these four scenarios coming up with us. And then how do you take it up? So all these guidelines are, they are all there, and people have to follow it up to get a best effect. And we have this as a VIA guidelines as well. And then we, once we see this as positive, we go for early detection with a colposcopy. We know that colposcopy directed biopsy is a gold standard. We know the indications for colposcopy is hyperkeratic patches or any screen positives, or even if your, you know, unhealthy cervix also can go for colposcopy. We know about all the steps by different steps for colposcopy, by which then we will be doing a sweet scoring, and then we get it. So now this is something which I've just quickly brought it up for you, that if in case we do you know, colposcopy, we will be getting this images also. Slowly, HSIL, you know, high grade lesions will, once you start putting in acetic acid for one complete minute, and then you are interpreting it for one more minute. So you do goes, the steps goes with normal saline, then the second step goes is with green filter, the third step goes is with 1 minute of application of 5% diluted acetic acid, and then reading for 1 minute and then doing your procedure, then is your Lugol's application. Once done this, definitely we do have understanding of, now this is completely a different, I'm not going to take time on colposcopy because my subject is now different, not completely focusing on colposcopy. We have to have a broader perspective whenever we are talking about cancer elimination. But yes, colposcopy is a tool to understand where to take up a biopsy. When we understand the, when we sweet it, when we find it, that this is the, this thing, you know, suspected areas, we go with a punch biopsies. And yes, we can also go for a leap biopsy. Histopath is the gold standard for the CIN detections. And then we have plenty of, I brought all these disclaimers. These are all from my own atlas. So even the proceed, the videos are my own videos. So there's the disclaimer which I wanted to put. So this is an LCIL lesion which has been developed on colposcopy, sweeted to 4. This is again an HCIL lesion. You can see over here, mosaic patterns, there are multiple acetovite areas, which is again, Lugol's negative, and then you have this has been sweeted to 6 to A7, and that is an HCIL SYN2 detected on a histopath, of course. Then we have over here, this is another patch which is developed on colposcopy, sweeted to 8, and when we had taken up a biopsy to be taken up from SCJ, it is coming to HCIL, and this is an invasive SCC, which we are seeing over here. And adenocarcinoma also can be, this is also, we don't have to forget. So when we understand this, then we have the treatment, that's a tertiary prevention, which we do. And we are understanding the fact that this is the third pillar of elimination. So annually, you see over here, 530,000 cases are diagnosed and they are treated. So you should have a robust referral system. You should have a compliance with treatment. And we should be also, you know, whenever there's a precancerous condition, it can be comfortably treated with, you know, a case management can be done. You have to have that that bonding with the patient when you tell her, and she also, she give her a chance to understand it. A counseling is the basic tool when we talk about the case management. Talk to her that there's nothing to worry. We have got wonderful you know, treatments with ablation and excisional. And then once she is adapted to whatever we are talking, our signs, we have also developed, you know, through our Sainivas Healthcare, which is also in public, into the public domain. This is done exclusively for IEC material with an audiovisual YouTube videos, which we have brought in all different languages, multiple different languages, making her understand these signs so that she is, you know, in tune with what you're telling. And then you have ablative procedures. You can have this cryoablations, which goes with 353. This is a rapid freezing, slow thawing, and rapid freezing. So when you talk about cryoablation, the main thing is your nitrous cylinder or the carbon dioxide should be full. You can do a see and treat program if it is a screen and treat, if it is suiting your ablative, you know, it is suiting the criteria. And then when we do this with the cryo gun, we have 3 minutes of rapid freezing and then a slow thawing when you can, you know, the frost is gone away and the color has come back to pink. And then you again do a rapid freezing second time. So what it, how does it help you? It helps by, you know, the intracellular water is getting desiccated, it gets freezed, and that's how it gets denatured, and the NC cell, the, you know, the CIN cells get denatured and washes for in 21 days, and then you call her up for a follow-up. So the only thing is there can be a watery discharge, which you'll have to tell them. Another ablation method, which is again most suitable for the camp method, is a thermal ablation, where you have, you give pulses of 40 seconds, which is preheated again. And it's a very simple thing. It can be carried in your camp. And this is my video, which is a camp setting video, which I have taken up, where I have done a screen and treat at the same go. So what is the principle behind the thermoablation is the water gets vitrified and desiccated intracellular, thereby denaturing of those CIN cells. dysplastic cells, and that's how we get it. And this you can apply multiple places, even when the cryo doesn't suit, you know. Many times you've seen that the cryo ball, the CIN lesion should be within 2/3 of the cryo ball. But if it is not, and if it is a large size, the better to go for a thermal ablation. Bangladesh is doing a lot of work into thermoablation. And I believe in India, we can also get a strategy of getting it. And now this is a large loop excision of transformation zone. In this video, I'm showing how it can be done in our, if you don't have to do a general anesthesia, it's only an intracervical anesthesia, local anesthesia, using 2% xylocaine. And it's an OPD-based procedure, doesn't have any admission, safe procedure. Only thing we have to learn the technique very well. And then you slowly take up, you can take parts from up to down or from side to side. In this video of mine, I had to take two passes because when I've done one shave and I had to remove it and it was not complete with the above one. So you can see there was a little bit of the lesion which was remained, and then I had to now take up another pass and remove that lesion as well. So this is again, there has to be a little bit of a good training for doing this procedure. Whereas when you do an ablative procedure, the low learning curve, and you can really do it in a screen and treat program. That's the reason LEAP is taken up, excisionals are taken up in the see and treat program and not in the screen and treat program. So over here, we have shaved the other lesion as well, the remaining part. And then with a ball cautery, it's comfortably coagulated. And that's how we are getting a fantastic thing. Now what we do in a follow-up is we call her up at 6 months. We do a test of cure, then we call her up at, here we have to understand the margin-free areas, and the margin has to be free. And inadvertently, sometimes margins are involved. Still, we can just wait for 6 months, do a repeat follow-up. You can do a repeat excision if ever you find that the lesions are still there. But the test of cure with HPV and LBC is going to, and the cytology is going to help us out. After that, you do a second follow-up as a test of cure at 12 months and then at 24 months, and all the three showing negative, you can put her up at 5th year, and then every 5 yearly for 20 years. So this is something which is there, and these are certain posters brought up by WHO to be displayed into our OPD. I've come to the end of my talk. Now this is the book, which this is one of few books are there. I mean, definitely you can take up these as the guideline books to improve our knowledge. There are certain few books brought up by me through CBS publications as well. This atlas has been reviewed by WHO, Dr. Partha Basu. This was taken up in the, as a master trainer for MP government. Government took up this book as a tool also for training in the MP government, their medical officers. So of course, when we talk about tools and when we talk about the precision on doing all the therapies and colposcopy, we do have to have the right instruments in place with us. This is certain instruments. I mean, these are few of my own instruments designed by me, which has gone for patency with few specs designing change. This is sooner will be now released because of the COVID, that patency office is closed. So this is something, a lot of training and teaching programs, camps, mega camps being arranged. And something which we do at the community level also is, serving at the doorsteps. So we have this type of vans, vanity van, which we have developed into a screening module, a screening camp for, this is the first for cervical and breast cancer. This is the first chamber. This is the second chamber for registration and taking up the history. And then this is the third chamber, which is into, where we do actually the test of VIA and the clinical breast examination. So we have been doing this type of activities since past, two decades through our Sainivas Healthcare. And that has reaped a lot of benefits also. And we have been through my Pan-India operations, where we have about 26 centers Pan-India working on the same methodology. We have been able to touch almost 60,000 women till date. And so early detection can save a life. And let's join hands together to make India cervical cancer free. leaders don't force people to follow, but they invite on a journey. And that's what exactly Dr. Kunni Mohideen has done today by arranging this program along with KFOG. So thank you very much. We do have a ray of hope. And that's where I stop my deliberation. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you, ma'am. That was a really wonderful lecture. And should we take up the questions after the next session? Is it okay?
That's better.
So that we can have a broader audience interaction.
Right.
So with this few words, I would like to move on to the next session. So I shall be introducing the speakers. And we have Dr. Santosh Kuriakose, who is the gynecologic oncologist and associate professor, Division of Gynecologic Oncology, the Department of ONG, Government Medical College, Calicut. And he is also the chairperson of Oncology Committee, Kerala Federation of ONG. And we have Dr. Shalini Rajaram, and she is the head of the Department, Division of Gynec Oncology, AIIMS Rishikesh, and also the in charge of the department at UCMS and the Guru Tegh Bahadur Hospital, Delhi. And she is the past president of Association of Gynecologic Oncologists of India and the president of Society for Vaginal Surgeons in Delhi. And she has served as the past president and the executive member of various organizations. And she was the former chairperson of AOGD Oncology Committee. And she has a lot of publications in to her credit, both national and international, more than 150. And she's a keen orator and dedicated teacher, gynec oncosurgeon, laparoscopic and vaginal surgeon as well. And we have Dr. Manish Chandra, and who is a radiation oncologist, practicing radiation oncologist since 21 years. And Sir has managed 150 bedded cancer hospital at Nasik, and joined Jupiter Hospital Thane as a radiation oncologist in 2008 and continuing till date. And he has started a population-based pap smear campaign in the city of Nasik and designed special template for CA cervix brachytherapy and presented an Indian series, which is 125 patients of CA cervix 2B to 4A with 2-year local control rate of 98% at ASTRO. And sir is a DNB teacher for the last 7 years. And once I got the number from Dr. Priya, the number was saved as Jupiter Manish. So I really wondered what this Jupiter means. So once I have gone through sir's CV, I found this is the correlation. And we have Dr. Puneet Chantna, the clinician, scientist, academician, entrepreneur, and the precision oncologist. And a really good, the CV is so extensive, and he has mentioned about his academic and the professional achievements. He's a MD in internal medicine with PhD in biophysics, a very rare combination. And he's a lead in international deployment of blockchain technology in precision oncology and CAR cell therapy. And it was very interesting to know that there is a sub thing like a precision oncology. So I just went across that topic in detail later on. And he has continuous endeavors and passion to learn, has been endorsed as certifications in precision medicine across multi-specialties of cardiology, oncology, diabetes, nutrition from Harvard School, US, and University of Pennsylvania. And he has a lot of publications, and he has a long vision, and he drives business endeavor at two of his enterprises and advises many wellness and business service groups, strives to pave futuristic healthcare through fusion of biomedicine and biotechnology to explain, manage and transform lives past and beyond technology, diagnostics, wellness and training. That's really wonderful. And we have Dr. Sandeep Mathur. Sir is the professor of pathology, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. And he had his MBBS from Nagpur and MD in pathology from GMC, Mumbai. And sir's area of interest is in pathology of breast and cytopathology. And a lot of publications to his credits in indexed journals. founder and current secretary of Delhi chapter of Indian Academy of Cytologists and fellow of International Academy of Cytology and the life member of International Society of Gynecology and member of National Academy of Medical Sciences and the life member of AOGIN India and recipient of AIIMS Excellence Award. And we have Dr. Adarsh Dharmarajan, and really thankful to Dr. Adarsh who has accepted our invitation to join at the last moment. And we had his program earlier in our society as well. And Doctor is the assistant professor, the Department of Surgical Oncology, Malabar Cancer Center, Kannur. And that's one of the leading cancer center in the Northern Kerala. And he has 5 publications in index journals. And the area of interest is carcinoma of ovaries. So with this few introduction, I hand over the mic to Dr. Santosh Kuriakose to proceed with the panel discussion with the tumor board. Over to Dr. Santosh.
So good morning to all the distinguished panelists as well as the audience. So today is World Gynecological Cancer Awareness Day. So one emphasis we gave was cervical cancer prevention. The other emphasis, as we keep on screening, we are likely to get women at very early stages of cancer. So we should be, the societies as well as the gynecologists should be equipped enough to be able to take up this challenge. Very saddening or disheartening point is a woman planning for a family, dreaming of a family and found with a diagnosis of cancer. So we thought specifically of focusing this subgroup. So we have, so I thank all my panelists. I think panelists have all, so I think we should not spending any more time. I will be sharing my screen and I will be going to the, we have got 3 cases for discussion. I think we will go straight ahead to the cases, okay? Okay. So the screen is visible?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So welcome to all panelists. So the first case is a 36-year-old lady. She is married 3 years and not yet conceived. Rightfully, she is anxious about that conception issues. She is having quite irregular cycles and delayed. And she has a mother who is diabetic and hypertensive. And she is quite obese, we should say, moderate. The BMI is 33, her weight is 80 kilogram. And clinical examination is, apart from a bulky uterus, it looks normal. But her investigations are certainly, there are certain abnormalities. You can very well see that her day 3 LH is a little on the higher side. The progesterone on day 22 is very low. That means she is not ovulating. And the fasting and postprandial blood sugars are very high. And her insulin levels are also on the very high side. So what will we like to do with this patient? So her ultrasound was already taken by the gynecologist. You can see the endometrium is very thickened. It is 22 millimeter and the Doppler was also done, which shows an increased blood flow in the endometrial vessels. So they have already done a endometrial sampling. So this is one scenario that we come across, thickened endometrium. So for the postgraduates, the more than anything, more than 11 or 12 millimeter in this age group is normal. And we have to do a sampling. And rightfully done, we have done a PIPLA or endometrial aspiration done. And we have the HPR report. So I will invite Dr. Sandeep Mathur, he's the professor of pathology, All India Institute, to comment on the histopathology. Dr. Mathur.
Okay, yes. So this is endometrial aspirate. What I see here are back-to-back glands as seen in the panel A. And these glands, there doesn't at places seem to be any distinction between them. That means one gland, there's fusion of these glands. Although the nuclear features at the higher magnification over here, they showed increased stratification, slight hyperchromasia, but there's no marked ATP as such. And you know, this kind of a pattern is definitely more like a carcinoma, because fusion of glands is a feature of carcinoma. And we don't generally expect an endometrioid variety of carcinoma where very much marked ATP or anything. And this, I presume, all that's not labeled must be the ER or PR staining. It's the nuclear staining which is highlighted. So ER, PR are standard treatments. So if I were to report this case, looking at these pictures, I would say that this is a well-differentiated or FIGO grade 1 endometrioid adenocarcinoma, although the exact estimation of the solid area would only be possible in the resection. But looking at it, it is at least a grade 1 kind of a lesion, well-differentiated endometrioid carcinoma. No doubts in calling this a carcinoma. This is definitely not beyond complex hyperplasia or atypical hyperplasia, as one would see. And of course, since it's only an endometrial biopsy, I will not be able to comment about the other things like myometrial invasion, LVSI, etc., because the deeper tissue is not included in this.
Right. Dr. Madhu, thank you very much. You have got two points mentioned very clearly. The glands are very thickly packed and the stroma is quite low, and there is some amount of atypicality, and you will rightly put it as endometrioid carcinoma, and the PR status is probably positive in this case.
Yes.
But mostly we don't get this. A pathologist is not this gracious enough to give this report. Most of the time we get a report, complex atypical hyperplasia. Yeah. This is where a lot of people get confused. So how do we go about that situation, Dr. Mathur?
Yeah, anything less than this, for example, the picture which you have shown is very clear. I don't think anybody will call this a complex atypical. That will be a terrible downgrade of the lesion. So when there is clear-cut fusion of the glands, prominent papillary architecture, and all those things, so that time I think my pathologist should be conclusive enough to call it. But anything short of that, and you know, sometimes it happens that in the biopsy, such changes are very focal and scant.
Okay.
That is the situation where we hesitate to go all out and call it. So many a times we word it as if it's a complex hyperplasia, possibility of a well-differentiated endometrioid cannot be explained.
Okay, a general practitioner, when he or she gets this complex atypical hyperplasia, what percentage do we expect this malignancy in the final specimen?
Yeah, so it's a very, very difficult to say the exact percentage, but you know, this kind of a diagnosis predicts a high possibility of it being an endometrial carcinoma whenever somebody's calling it a complex, okay. Because
yes.
It's a kind of a change which you see adjacent, yes, to a well-differentiated endometrium. When the final, yes, specimen, this is a change which you commonly see in adjacent endometrium.
Yes.
It's a kind of it would raise a red flag definitely.
Okay.
With this kind of a diagnosis, the chances are high.
So the complex atypical hyperplasia itself should give a red flag that it is a malignancy. Yes.
Definitely a well-differentiated one.
Yeah. Yes. Very, very, very. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sandor, sir.
Yes.
I want to add one thing. Even during your frozen section, in such cases, complex hyperplasia, such cases, it's very difficult to differentiate between invasive and non-invasive kind of disease. Sometimes it's very difficult.
Exactly.
Like this. So, yeah.
Exactly.
But the good thing is that even if it is invasive carcinoma also, so THPSO is enough in such cases. No need for lymph node dissection. So it will not affect the management part as such.
But the point is how accurate we are is the key question. So do we have any other methods to evaluate preoperatively and say this is likely to be malignant? Or is the question? So we have a diagnosis of fertility. We have a diagnosis of possible carcinoma endometrium in this case. So, and this lady is obviously worried, and you can see her face.
Yes, you might have all seen such patients. So my question is all to Dr. Shalini Rajaram, madam. She is she is one of the doyens of this field of gyne oncology in India. So I think over to you. The podium is yours, madam.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Santosh. So this is definitely a devastating diagnosis to the woman because she's anxious to conceive. She's come to an infertility clinic. And coming to an infertility clinic, getting a diagnosis of cancer, something which is going to shatter her. But we'll have to counsel the woman. And if she's very, very keen on fertility preservation, it can be done. But we'll have to do a few tests, more like an MRI, to see whether there is invasion or no invasion. We'll have to counsel her and tell her that the standard treatment is definitely total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo oophorectomy. And depending on invasion, depending on risk factors, we can...
I think we have... Madam, may I stop?
This is the MRI picture. We need to get an MRI done and see whether it's confined to the endometrium. And also, at the same time, counsel her that her weight is a problem at this point. And even if she wants to undergo a conservative management, it is possible. There have been responses to conservative management of progestins and intrauterine contraceptive devices. And if it is confined to the endometrium, there's a clear junctional zone visible. It can be offered to her. But of course, she has to know very, very well that it is not the standard treatment. It is something that we're going to try with hormonal management. And if she responds in the next 6 to 9 months, well and good, we can preserve her fertility, and then probably after that she can go in for an ART. So this is what we would counsel a woman with an endometrial cancer, well-differentiated young woman, but at the same time she has to undergo weight loss and other management for her obesity.
So that is very clear. So we have to take an MRI. MRI will let us know about the myometrial invasion. As we rightly pointed out, the junctional zone is intact in this particular case, and there is no myometrial invasion. And another point of that worries us is the synchronous ovarian tumors, which especially is so if it is an endometrioid histology. So MRI is good enough, or do you really want to do a laparoscopy? I won't go in for a laparoscopy. Do you think the laparoscopy is required in this case?
May not be required, but sometimes you do find these ovaries are enlarged in these young women, either because of polycystic ovaries or because of some cysts. And also, I think it's not a bad idea to put in a laparoscope and evaluate the ovaries, but not necessary all the time. I think MRI imaging techniques are enough to diagnose an ovarian mass, and then we can take it further from there.
Madam, whether we should go for a colonoscopy in this particular case? She can be a hereditary, part of a Lynch syndrome, she had this. So her age is also, she is very young. So whether we should go for a colonoscopy before going?
No, I think the biopsy sample itself could be evaluated for the Lynch. So Dr. Sandeep, is this biopsy sample sufficient to
look for? But as I said, there can be synchronous tumors.
Yes, we will come to that. I think we have already included that part in the coming slide.
Yeah. So probably we'll,
So this patient is a patient for endometrial carcinoma, no doubt about that. And she has an option to preserve fertility. Is that clear? And one thing, madam, has very well clearly said, this is the NCCN guideline, that this is not the standard of care for treating endometrial cancer. It should be very clear. It should be written in bold letters. It should be counseled. It should be written on white paper, and signature of the patient as well as his husband should be put and should be kept in your file whenever you go for this.
But at the same time, Santosh, we shouldn't scare her so much because she has a well-differentiated carcinoma. She can respond to treatment. We tell them, take their signatures, tell them it's not the standard care, but at the same time, probably offer it to them. I don't think we should scare her off in this kind, because we're going to monitor her. We're going to give her progestins. Okay. We're going to monitor her. Okay. So let's not scare her.
How are you going to treat her, madam?
Yeah, I normally do both. I give progestins and put in an LNG IUD. And I think the conception rates are much better. Response rates are much better. with both LNG-IUS, and I use megestrol acetate in the dose of maybe 160 milligrams BD for this patient, because she's quite overweight, obese, so she'll require higher dose. There's no exact dose that has been given in various books or various articles. So I use in thinner women, maybe 80 milligrams twice a day, but I would prefer to use a higher dose of megestrol acetate. And medroxyprogesterone acetate, we don't have 100 or 200 milligram tablets. We have just 10 milligram tablets. Yeah. So that's not a good choice in India. Maybe abroad they have 100 and 200 milligram tablets. So Mejace is something that is available and we could try. And definitely put in an LNG-IUS. And a lot of studies say just progestins is sufficient. But I would be very, very wary and very scared to just leave her alone with progestins. I would like to put in an LNG-IUS.
So you mean that, what was your result? But how did you find this help? What is your experience, personal experience?
Personal experience, they do respond. I have about two patients who did respond and then went on to have pregnancies. But there were one or two patients who didn't respond and the weight did not come down. And we did have to do a hysterectomy at the end of about 9 months. So we've had problems too. But we should give them every chance, especially in this young woman. And in these days of fertility preservation, which is so important, women postponing their pregnancies, women who are a lot of PCOS cases, a lot of obesity cases, I think we should offer them hormonal treatment.
Yes, yes. So I think, madam, as this is the response rate, around 70% is the response rate. And as madam rightly said, you should not be frightening the lady, but keep looking at her. How frequently do you want to do the endometrial sampling? Maybe how often?
Yeah, what is recommended is 4 months. At least the first one should be 4 months later. But some people do it 6 months later. Maybe you can monitor it with a transvaginal sonography and see the thickness of the endometrium. But it has to be done between 4 to 6 months.
Okay. Once it has reverted, you can...
We can continue it for another 3 months. And then probably go on to ART.
And it's very important that you should know the progesterone status also, receptor status, because the response is also somewhat related to this progesterone receptor status.
But usually it is seen that the progesterone receptor state, ERPR status, is very good in these patients. Maybe later on you can ask Sandeep or Puneet. The response, the receptor status is good in well-differentiated adenocarcinomas.
Okay, thank you, madam. We'll come back to you. The thing is, again, Dr. Adarsh has actually brought in a new question. What about thinking in terms of a Lynch syndrome? Or so is there any role for doing this? Histopathology is already there with us. Do you want to do the recent TCGA classification is there? So Dr. Puneet Chandra Channa, he's the medical oncologist and precision oncologist. I think you are the right person to tell us about this. Dr. Puneet?
He's not there?
Can you hear me now? Yeah, I'm here.
Yes, sorry. I just started speaking.
All right, great. I would, on the fertility preservation, I would slightly like to differ here and still emphasize on the point that the preoperative counseling and informed consent has to be obtained from the patient without scaring, of course, yes. Not only for current case, but also for example the granulosa cell and the Sertoli cell tumors.
Yeah.
Where we have only one ovary involved, and of course, as one of my colleague talked about, is the synchronous tumors. Rather, we may have something which may be coming up on the the synchronous types also, wherein we may look at the high grade or the high stage disease. In terms of the genetic, but then I would say molecular specific to immunohistochemistry. So I'm sure, doctor. Unfortunately, in these cases, here we do not the pre-operative but a post-operative staging in EOC. That's the kind of limitation, which is why we have to talk to the patient even in the cases of thecomas, wherein commonly the cause is the estrogen effects and what kind of things she may want to look at.
So the I think it is very clear that people are nowadays using this, the recent TCGA classification. You can do it in the histopathology, preoperative histopathology also. And if the pole sequence is negative, and if the MMR protein IHC, that is, if you get the MLH1, PMS2, or MSH2 or 6, if it's positive, then there may be a role for doing a colonoscopy. I think that was others' question in this particular case.
Yeah, I would agree.
That particular patient, you may go for. Again, I have a very big question here. I don't have an answer to that. And if the patient is actually categorized as serous carcinoma or this copy number high group category, that means it is likely to be 53 IHC positive. Are we actually justified in keeping such patients for fertility preservation? My personal answer is no. I won't be comfortable at all in keeping such patients. And I think in the next NCCN review, we'll get a better idea or a confirmatory guideline in that issue.
Dr. Santosh, can I say a word?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. This copy number high are usually seen in older women, type 2 cancers, not in type 1 cancers. Yes. And we are going to conserve the uterus only in type 1 cancers. So I think copy number high is not seen in type 1 usually, maybe an occasional chance, but it's in type 2 cancer.
Right.
Yeah, this session,
one word I would like to add.
Sure, yeah. Sandeep. Please,
Sandeep. Dr. Sandeep.
Yeah. So regarding P53C, you should also go by the morphology. Okay, if the tumor is looking like an endometrioid carcinoma, and you still do a P50, there will be around 10-15% of cases, or maybe lower, who may turn out to be high P53 positivity, but that doesn't make it a serous carcinoma.
Okay.
So that scenario where the question you are saying is whether we can still go ahead, I think you can. Because that's not actually a serous carcinoma or a copy number high carcinoma, although it is P50. So morphology is also, you have to take in consideration before you diagnose something as a copy number high or a serous carcinoma.
Okay. So I think the question is clear. So based on this, If you have the possibility of doing these things, you can do a pole sequencing and at least the IHC for MMR proteins as well as P53, if you have the facility.
One question to Dr. Sandeep, is it possible to do it on an endometrial biopsy sample, or you would like the hysterectomy sample to give your MMR receptor?
No, MMR is possible even on biopsy. It's
okay.
Because it's so a loss, loss which you have to see.
So that's enough to do MS.
Counting for some heterogeneity in the tumor, I mean, by and large, it should work even on biopsy.
Okay, thank you.
So I think we are now going to the particular patient again. What about the oncological success, Dr. Adarsh? I think we should all give it a great thanks to Adarsh, because Dr. Ranu was to present this case. Actually, she had to back off because of her family issues. Adarsh was very, very, very gracious enough to accept our invitation. He's the assistant professor in the Department of Gynae Oncology Division, Department of Surgical Oncology, Malabar Cancer. So over to you, Adarsh.
Same case you are discussing now. Same case.
Yes.
Yeah, in the same case, actually, madam has already mentioned there is well-differentiated endometrioid one-day cancer. The chances of regression with progesterone itself is about 70-75%. But there is high, so the rate of relapse is very high, 30-45% chances of relapse or progression for this particular cases. That is a main area of concern. Otherwise, the chance of regression is about 70-75%. Anyway, we are doing endometrial sampling every 3 to 6 months and continuous monitoring, and with the USG, we can early detect such problem. So,
and after her conception, do you want to go ahead with complete surgery or?
I'm not getting, sir.
If the patient finally conceive and she has a baby, she'll definitely be asking you, what about my uterus, doctor? So what will be your answer?
Definitely, I will give her option of a surgery only, a completion surgery, definitely.
Is it an option or you should?
I should give her option of completion surgery.
Ideally, allow me to add, sir. I think by the age of 35, we should counsel the patient that immediately after conceiving and after delivery, she should opt out for hysterectomy or the combined procedure.
Yeah, I think there is no confusion about that.
There is no confusion about that aspect.
So about this, there is a study actually. What is the result rate? I think this has already been covered. But one point is the as Madam has already said, Shalini Madam has very well clear, the progestin plus LNG IUD is the best result, 87% clearance rate. And progestin alone, as Madam said, we will not be using it because it is much less effective. Okay, back to our focal point. Dr. Kunjamedin, what do you think this, the pregnancy rates, and you might have already seen these patients. What do you think this woman now will, what do you think about her success rate of being conceiving?
Actually, the patients who conceive following this ART procedures, generally they do have a pregnancy rate of around 40% to 60%. Per se, but malignant patients, those who have treated for malignancy as such, they have a reduced chance of pregnancy rate, mainly because their oocyte quality will be less, mainly just due to this malignant status in their body. So we don't get very often that good pregnancy rate, just like in a normal human in this particular cases. And the second situation is because mostly they have to go for ART only. So the hormones, the stimulations which we are using, that can create the abnormal amount of estradiol in the serum. That can also cause a tumor relapse in the future.
And what about the thin, Dr. Kunjamedin, when the you give progestins for a long time, 3 to 6 months or 9 months, the endometrium must be becoming very thin. So is how do you take care of the thin endometrium?
Generally, the endometrium will be thin following this long-term progesterone therapy, intrauterine devices which delivers the progesterone. So generally, what we do, in such cases, because we cannot give estrogens in such situations, but generally we depend on the natural cycles. We generally go on the natural cycles and see whether the endometrium is improving naturally. And sometimes we use PRP as well.
Okay. I think Dr. Kunjamedin has a lot of wisdom added into that question. The question is very significant. Shalini Madam's question is very significant. And answer, I think, is very well answered.
Yeah.
I think, what about pregnancy outcome?
Yeah, the pregnancy, in general, once they conceive, the general outcome won't be that difficult. The pregnancy outcome that usually is said to be 34% with the progestin treatment, and it was 18% with the intrauterine device that already mentioned in this slide. And the few studies have shown they even deliver the multiple pregnancy. But pregnancy rate with progestin plus LNG IUD, that is supposed to be around 35 to 40%, and that they do have a good percentage of term deliveries as well.
Okay, so we get a 30 to 40% take-home baby rate. Okay, so again coming back to Dr. Shalini Madam, this patient has actually conceived. We will hope for the best. She has a baby, and we are planning for a surgery for her. And what about she's 35 years, what about ovarian conservation? That's a big question again.
Yeah, I know. I think we've been taught as undergraduates, postgraduates, and for a long, long time that the ovaries are involved in endometrial cancer in about 8 to 10% of the time. It's an estrogen dependent disease. So we should get the ovaries out in women who have endometrial cancer. That has been the traditional teaching. But I think over the years, it has been seen that endometrial cancer occurs in younger and younger women. It has been occurring in younger and younger women. And a lot of studies have found that there is no evidence that conservation of the ovaries will actually cause an increase in recurrence rates. Either whether you conserve or you don't conserve, the recurrence rates are same. So a lot of people, I think you can inspect the ovaries at the time of surgery, and if ovaries look normal, I think you can go ahead and leave it. And of course, you will monitor maybe once a year to see whether the ovaries are normal or not, but it can be left behind. But people are still very scared to leave the ovaries behind once there's an endometrial cancer, but in young women, I think it can be left behind. It can be left behind. And there are enough studies to show that it is safe to leave the ovaries behind in young women.
Right. Does it mean, Dr. Shalini, advise us that does it mean that, you know, if the regression is not there in the endometrium post about 6 or 9 months, as you were talking about, do we still go for a biopsy before we go ahead and perform a procedure?
Yeah, that's how you'll know, no? Otherwise, how would you know that a patient is not responding?
Why don't we do it before? Through the hysterectomy or the double manual exam?
No. We'll do a biopsy at least two times, no? Once at 6 months, once at 9 months, and then only decide whether to terminate treatment or continue with the progestins or go ahead with the ART, right? So we'll know that beforehand. Right.
Maybe allow me to modify my question. Why not go for a DNP and try and pick up a biopsy and try and put the patient on the progestin later, or an IUD or both?
I didn't get your question.
Before planning for a pregnancy, can we do a biopsy?
Yes, definitely. We do a biopsy by endometrial sampling and make sure that the malignancy, the hyperplasia has actually reversed. Or it becomes a problem. Yeah. Okay, unless it is there, if this is not a patient, then if it still continues to be in the hyperplasia, say complex hyperplasia or endometrial malignancy possible, then we will not go ahead with this conception and things like that.
Right.
That
is out of question. To Dr. Mathur again. So, Dr. Mathur, we go with the biopsy to confirm, right?
Yes.
So, they do send us biopsies. Actually, what in fine fact, sometimes you get multiple biopsies in such patients, and we always compare with the prior biopsy. Whether the change has completely reversed or there has been same, or there has been also, many a times we get very partial response, you know. There is focal presence of hyperplasia still and the rest of it is showing decidualized endometrium.
Yeah.
This kind of real life.
Would you advise the sequencing at that stage?
Pardon?
Parallel sequencing? Would you advise the sequencing?
Now, how would that help? But
no, it won't help. Right now, if the patient had good response, the infertilologists take over and take the patient for fertility. And if it is not respond, we take over and do the surgery. That's it.
Right. Dr. Santosh, there was a question on, can you put two LNG IUS?
I have never heard of that. Even putting one is a difficult thing. Putting two is even
more. No. Putting one is not difficult, Dr. Santosh. Putting one is not difficult.
Anyway, that is a very good question to ask. I think I never thought about that. I think you only could think of such out-of-box scenarios and treatment options. I think that will be a good answer. I think that's a very good method to look into.
Somebody put it up that there are UK trials saying that there's LNG-IUS. Two LNG-IUS can be used, but I have not heard of it. So we'll have
to. Really, that will be a good thing to do if it is possible.
Yeah.
Because she has only, after all, 1 year. I think that is fairly a good time for her to us to keep the patient.
I think Dr. Shekharan has also said, Dr. Shekharan said you can put in two IUS too, LNG IUS, so it's something new.
If Dr. Shekharan says, we will just take it just because his word is final.
Right.
So ovarian preservation is now has become acceptable. That is what is our final message. Yes.
Yeah. If you can rule out METs and if you can rule out synchronous ovarian cancer.
Yes. One more question. Suppose the final HPR is most of the time different from what we actually thought it was. So we are operating this patient and that particular point, you find it is stage 1B, grade 3 and things like that. So what is the radiation oncologist perspective and points to be remembered for us, for us surgeons? Dr. Manish Chandra is a radiation oncologist from Thane. He has got a lot of work, especially in the field of cervical cancer and IORTs. So over to you, Dr. Manish. Dr. Manish.
Hello.
Yes.
So whenever we see a case of CA endometrium post-operative, what we are more interested in, the number one is the grade of the tumor, whether this is a high grade, low grade, age of the patient, and we have to look at the depth of the tumor, nodal involvement. These are the important things that we have to notice. And if it is a nodal involvement is there and ovarian involvement is there, then we have to add chemotherapy along with radiation. If nodal involvement is not there, if it is grade 1 tumor, less than 50%, we will do nothing. We just keep this patient under close observation. So the option varies from close observation to vaginal brachytherapy to radiation therapy or radiation therapy plus chemotherapy. So these are the various options that we have in adjuvant setting of CA endometrium.
Okay. Since we are thinking in terms of preserving our estrogen function, what will you like to do at our time of surgery with regard to our ovaries?
What we do, we suggest them ki if they are thinking of, then do a ovarian transposition above the aortic bifurcation. Okay. Because our radiation field sometime go up till aortic bifurcation. So if they are planning for aortic this ovarian transposition, it should be done above the bifurcation.
So that is
I know this is technically very challenging sometimes, because when we discuss with our patient, not in these cases, but in cases of CA rectum, when we see in CA rectum young patient, we ask our surgical oncologist to do ovarian transposition, and we request them in those cases to remain above common iliac bifurcation. But whenever we are doing an endometrium, then we have asked to request them to be above aortic bifurcation.
Okay. I don't think it is difficult. It is a thing that we are doing. Mm-hmm. Something that can be done, I think, both laparoscopically as well as by open, whatever method you can. I think the best method of treatment in endometrial cancer, at least, is a minimally invasive surgery.
One question, Dr. Santosh, to the radiation oncologist. Is it sufficient to transpose it just above the bifurcation, because all our para-aortic nodes are above the bifurcation? So in case she needs a higher...
When we are radiating these patients, so pelvic radiation includes more radiation. So the ovarian bed or ovary will be radiated. But if you are putting it above aortic bifurcation, and if we have to radiate para-aortic nodes, so para-aortic chain is just the anterior vertebral thing that we have to radiate. Only the chain. Nowadays, with well-confirmed radiotherapy, we are radiating around maximum around 7 to 8 millimeter around the blood vessels.
Okay.
So in that case, if it is roughly around 3 centimeter lateral to spine, that is more than enough. And radiation dose there, we can very well control. So what we tell our surgical oncologist colleague, whenever they are doing ovarian transposition, put their clips there, so that we mark it as our organ at risk. And we calculate that the dose received by that area is less than the ovarian tolerance.
Okay.
Yes. Very vital point. Put it a clip on that ovary so that the radiation oncologist can identify.
And laterally also. Laterally and higher.
It should be laterally. It should be minimum around 3 to 4 centimeter from the lateral border of the vertebra. If you can.
Yes.
Fine.
That is one thing, and single clip should be avoided, because sometimes there is a chances of these clips
falling.
So at least 2 to 3 clips should be put, so that we can very well identify that these are the orientation of the clip, and we can reproduce the ovary, because you know it very well, on a CT, reproducing ovary is very difficult.
Yes, so this is the importance of tumor board. Actually, Dr. Manish, who is a radiation oncologist, is teaching the surgeon what to do.
No, I'm telling the surgeon what is my requirement.
Yeah.
The things we overlook. No, sometimes we forget to put the clips, because in the surgical things, we routinely don't put clips unless it is a particular thing that is required.
Yeah.
So unless you remind us, we will actually forget to put clips actually at that time.
Let me put it, we see more, we do this kind of transposition more in younger female with CA rectum rather than CA endometrium.
Okay.
Because somehow the approach in endometrium is to go a little more radical. So there are very few patients, I think in last 20 years that I am practicing, I have seen only one patient who agreed for fertility preservation. Rest all gives the preference to the disease over the fertility.
Yeah.
Right. I think that is going to increase in the coming days. I think so. So I think most of the topics we have covered in this case, and except one point we haven't covered is the need of If you are doing a minimally invasive surgery, you can go for a sentinel lymph node biopsy. In this particular case, that would be very beneficial for the patient as well. So I think we have, Dr. Puneet has very well summarized all the points. Treatment.
Sorry, yes, about
anything
that.
More to add, Dr. Puneet?
Yeah, so I think the next one follows. We have another case, right? No. So that's the last one.
Yes. No, we have got two more cases.
Right. So I think the molecular aspect is yet to come because yes. I was holding on to some information which will answer the type 1 endometrial carcinomas and, you know, the role of mutations and how we could go back to the old case and try and confirm and, you know, the risk factors.
Yeah. I think I will agree with Puneet is that nowadays the things in endometrium or the scenario in endometrium cancer is totally different from what we have been doing. Some of these genetic tests are not being done here as of today, but it is just a matter of time that we would be doing those tests here also.
Right. Yeah. If allowed to summarize on the type 1 at least at the moment.
I think, Puneet, we can touch upon this right now. Just a brief summary at this time.
Sure. All right. Fair enough. So we have mutations, which is like, you know, the P10 mutations, PIK3CA, which is an oncogene, and the ARID1A. These are three genes, you know, wherein there is a pathway that there's a PIK3 pathway which is activated, which is responsible for the growth and the replication of endometrial cells. More signaling to this pathway will, of course, you know, enhance the expression of the genes related to the estrogen receptors. So high levels of estrogen will again cause the, you know, issues atypical hyperplasia and risk of endometrial cancer. So I believe that the in the type 1 as well, the molecular evaluation can help.
Yes.
Besides, the other risk factors we all know is tamoxifen and, you know, the estrogens.
The practical issue is that, so we are going to do this genetic evaluation on the endometrial sampling specimen. Okay.
Yes.
Right. The thing is, I have less sample. So
even with NGS, even with next generation sequencing, it will take some minimum 15 to 30 days now.
All right. So that's a separate. There are, you know, when we say molecular, unfortunately, we believe that is only DNA. It is only genetics. I believe it is MSI. It is MMR. Yes, it is a combination of a lot of things. I am sure Dr. Sandeep would agree with me. So we were to pick up on the poll and other things, the TCGA, which I didn't answer earlier. So it's a combination of things, which is like even the proteins, which are, you know, translated into proteins, the genetic code. So we have a lot of, you know, even for the serous carcinomas in type 2, we have the TP53 mutation panels, the aneuploidies can be looked upon, and we can take it up from there. Now the molecular subtypes are also available on the TCGA guidelines, which, you know, bifurcate, you know, or subclassify the tumors into POL, which is the, you know, epsilon, enzyme. And we have ultra-mutated ones. We have MSI hyper-mutated tumors, and, you know, which can help you decide the, you know, the downstream pathway, the copy number, which is, could be low, or a copy number that's high, alongside the P53.
I think we in Calicut Medical College, we are doing that project now. We are closing into 100 patients right now. All right. Of all these mutations, we'll be checking. So next year, I will come up with the answer to most of these questions. Sure. Hopefully.
Yeah.
Sure. So it's a science and engineering research board project. So right. We are closing in on our. So I think we are going in for the next case. I think this slide, Dr. Shalini Madam has sent.
Yeah.
So obesity and animal cancer. So this, the take-home message is keep the weights low.
Yes.
So we are going to the next case. So. This is a 25-year-old Nalli Paris lady. This patient is recently married. This was the case given by Dr. Ranu. And she has an MRI which shows an 18-centimeter lesion which has solid and cystic areas and no ascites. The radiologist has given a diagnosis, probable malignancy. And her CA-125 is 150. And she wants definitely to conserve her fertility. And I want to add this film. This is a real patient who is in my ward under my care. She is a 17-year-old girl with an ovarian mass quite big. And this is the CT scan. Dr. Adarsh, can you just comment on the CT and
And the CT is showing a large unnecessary cyst, almost some 20 centimeters with solid cystic areas. It is more likely to be a malignant lesion anyway. And going to her the differential diagnosis, considering her age, our first diagnosis it can be a germ cell tumor of ovary.
Okay. So what? How will you evaluate this lady?
Yeah, that's one possibility is a germ cell tumor of ovary. We should think of other possibilities also. So I'll just tell other possibilities. Even epithelial ovarian cancer with a hereditary origin, okay, with a high penetrant gene, she can present with a serous carcinoma also. In such scenario, we should, even if it is a least possibility, we should also think of a metastatic origin also. Even okay. If it is not there is no bilaterality or any classic signs of Krukenberg tumor, we should always, because she is a menstruating lady, we should always think of another primary also in this case. So we should always, in history, we should always rule out upper GI symptoms, because many times we went across such cases, especially 20 patients in 20s and 30s, evaluated for by adenexal mass, finally ended up in primary GI tumors. Okay,
if it is a metastatic, very, very important. Important take home message.
Yeah, because solid elements also there. If it is a Krukenberg tumor, she is purely palliative. She should get purely palliative treatment. No need for all aggressive surgical management and all. So these are the possibilities.
So what surgery will you plan? Parents are concerned.
Definitely, we will go for a staging laparotomy for her. The first and foremost thing, first thing I want to say is that when we go to surgery, we should talk about the incision. First about the incision, please go ahead with a adequate vertical incision. Okay, because adequate vertical incision, in this particular case, sir told that only ovarian lesion is there. If you are doubtful about inoperability, I will advise, please put a diagnostic lab and see and assess the operability. Don't go for a big incision and all. So in this case, it is not like that. Only a adenexal mass is there. So put a adequate vertical incision, because as we know, you should take the tumor without rupture. So if you rupture the tumor, definitely it will upstage. As we know, an early stage tumor, 1A, 1B, and grade 1, grade 2 non-clear cell tumors doesn't need adjuvant treatment. If you rupture it, we will upstage this tumor and she will require adjuvant chemotherapy. So avoid such situation. So I never tell that you should go put an incision up to sternum. We can put an adequate incision, vertical incision, take the mass, send it for frozen section. Before that, we should do a thorough inspection. Peritoneal washing should be taken and it should be sent for frozen section. So if needed only, you should extend the incision. Okay. If this came as a benign or something which do not require a parotid retroperitoneal node dissection, you need not go up to sternum. So according to the situation, we should go. So first we should send it for frozen section. Definitely her age is 17 years and we should consider, if it's a germ cell tumor, we should consider a fertility preservation for her. We have to go for a unilateral salpingo oophorectomy and infracolic omentectomy and lymph node dissection, both pelvic and parotid lymph node dissection. There are controversies regarding this node dissection, whether it is beneficial or not, but still we are following our protocol. We usually address nodes also.
Santosh, can I add a word?
Yeah.
Suppose we are sure it's a germ cell tumor, and can we give neoadjuvant chemotherapy with 3 cycles of BP before we operate? Then we can reduce the size of the incision. There are papers. I think Kidwai Memorial does it. Dr. Bafna does it. So is it the standard of care, or it is only in certain centers that it is done?
Only in certain centers. No, only in certain centers. Actually, this is a primary operable case. In any ovarian cancer, primary cytoreduction is a standard.
No, that's fine, Dr. Adarsh. This is a 17-year-old girl. She may be having a tumor up to the sternum. You don't want to give her an incision from the sternum to the pubic symphysis. So can we give a neoadjuvant to reduce the size of the tumor so that she doesn't have an incision.
That is not an actual indication. I don't think it is an actual indication. I will give preference to malignancy than any other thing.
No, it's a malignancy. We are not saying it's not a malignancy, but in this condition, because it's a germ cell tumor, they respond very well to BEP, that is the neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Can it be done? Because there are a lot of papers on this subject. It may not be the standard of care, but it is done in some centers. So
I don't think, madam, any level of evidence to support this.
Maybe okay. It's experimental at this stage. But I have a follow-on question, sir. I have a follow-on question. In the absence of suspicious nodes, let's imagine, pelvic and the para-aortic nodes, do you think it still should be sampled?
Because microscopic involvement can be there. In latest trials like Lyons trial and all, they are telling that even with the microscopic involvement, you are not supposed to take because it is not going to alter the survival. But in case of germ cell tumor of ovary, there is no level on evidence to suggest it is still a debatable matter whether we should address lymph node or not. But our institutional policy, we are addressing lymph nodes, especially dysgerminoma. It's one of the most common malignancy, germ cell malignancy.
Great.
Again, there's a controversy in this, Dr. Adar and Dr. Santosh. Yes. In young girls, even with dysgerminoma, not dysgerminoma, with other germ cell tumors, lymph node dissection is not indicated. This is the pediatric yes. society yes. of what
pediatric
society
guidelines.
They don't do pelvic and lymph node dissection in young girls. Agreed. Young children.
But young girls.
You can just open the retroperitoneum and you can just see the retroperitoneum and you can take suspicious nodes. So, you can do a sampling. There is no harm in doing sampling.
There's no harm is not the word. It is this thing by the Pediatric Society. So probably we can go back and look at it in young children.
I think
it's not difficult. Everything is easy to do, Dr. Adar. Yes. It's easy to open the retroperitoneum. But in a young child or a young girl, I think the consensus is we don't do a pelvic and para-aortic.
Yes. Dr. Shalini is very much right. There is a Pediatric Society guidelines regarding these malignant tumors. There is no need to assess the lymph nodes unless you see it in the preoperative imaging. In that particular situation, yes. But otherwise, you don't have to. And many situations, we did leave behind stuck nodes in the para-aortic region, especially in germ cell tumors, and they have melted away like anything after our chemotherapy. And
one good thing with germ cell tumor is that it's highly chemosensitive.
Yeah.
Even if you have in the opposite over, if you have a small lesion also, you can leave. Okay, it is a highly chemosensitive tumor. No need to address the other ovary. Okay.
Yes. So I think there's a fair good consensus here. There are a lot of controversies. But I also personally would go in for a neoadjuvant chemotherapy only if I'm convinced that it is beyond stage 2 or at least stage 3 or...
Maybe it's for the yolk sac. Yeah. Maybe it's for the yolk sac, Johnson.
But I have a doubt, sir. I have a doubt. Suppose it is a mixed germ cell tumors and it is having teratomatous element also, then whether you can avoid surgery.
No, surgery you cannot avoid.
What about nodes, madam? Nodes is not an issue. In this particular germ cell tumor, nodes is not an issue.
Under the teratoma, I believe teratomas which are mature or dysgerminomas which are in adolescence, both are malignant.
Yeah. Yeah.
They are malignant.
Whereas the mature one is benign.
That's a non-issue. Mature teratoma, we see it very, very frequently. And that's dealt with differently.
I think we are all oncologists. We are now thinking of ourselves only. Let us just make it very clear for the gynecologist friends who are with us.
Yeah.
So things are very clear. It is possible to do a fertility preserving surgery in stage 1A, ovarian epithelial cancers. Serous cancers, and in almost all germ cell tumors, we can do fertility preservation. That is good enough. We have to have a frozen section, and depending on the frozen section, you will have to do a complete staging with preservation of fertility. And another question, doctor, I think we are coming back to Dr. Kunjamaidin. What about her options for future fertility? Suppose you open up the patient and you find it is malignancy. Suppose you decide to take the whole thing out. So the patient is concerned, the family is concerned. can I keep my ovum? Can I keep my embryos? So all these are questions. Can I keep my normal ovaries?
Yeah. The situations are two, three situations we have to think about. One, if the patient already had a menarche and she is menstruating regularly, the option is, the best option is to preserve the oocytes. If the patient is married and the husband is having a normal semen analysis or at least few sperms, so we can do preserve the embryo cryopreservation. Because embryo cryopreservation, that is the one, especially with the advent of vitrification, embryo cryopreservation, that is the one which will give maximum recovery rate, post-thaw recovery rate of the embryos are very good comparing to the oocytes and the ovarian tissue. In my practice, we generally have, we have a tie-up with the nearby cancer center. From there, we accept cases for oocyte cryopreservation, embryo cryopreservation, sperm preservation, and testicular tissue preservation. So far, we have not done ovarian tissue cryopreservation and reimplantation or so and so. So that the very few cases have been done world over, and the recovery rate of oocytes from the cryopreserved ovary is very few. And moreover, the advantage of taking the oocytes or for the creating embryos, because we can take the oocytes by doing a random simulation protocol. And the idea is not to have the estradiol elevated beyond a certain limit. For that, generally what we do in an antagonist protocol, where we start the antagonist protocol at an early part of the menstrual cycle along with stimulation, and also we use letrozole to control the excess product, excess the to prevent the estradiol going beyond a particular level. So the to conclude that one, the ovum preservation, then comes the embryo preservation. These are the two things which we can do, reducing the time of for her to go for further treatment. And at this point, I would like to add one more point. One of our personal case experience, the patient initially reported with endometriosis. We treated for endometrioma surgery. Then the husband has died. After the endometrioma surgery, we generally advise them to have the conception within next 6 months. That is the maximum possible time. Unfortunately, after 1 month, the husband was diagnosed as having Hodgkin's lymphoma. He has been taken for, he was advised to have the chemotherapy. Then the husband has come for the sperm cryopreservation. Then we counseled them for embryo cryopreservation, that because that is more stable. They did the oocyte recovery, embryo cryopreservation, everything. But after this cryopreservation, while the husband is on chemotherapy, they got divorced. So the embryos are divorced. This lady then married another person. That person turned out to be, unfortunately, azoospermic. And not only that, azoospermia is that sort of a testicular failure. We cannot retrieve even sperms from the testes. Now she want to marry the first man again to get the embryo. Now the case is
that sounds only like a TV saga.
Dr. Kunjamedin can start a TV serial.
Yeah, I don't know how much you are aware. Ekta Kapoor serial sounds like exactly this like.
No sir, now see, because I'm just telling fluently, because that is, we are also part of battle.
Okay.
So, yes, yes. So anyway, embryo, the patient is original patient is on one side, ex-husband is on one side, and the fourth side is the present husband.
Okay. So it is a real, these are all so, real life-like issues.
All the legal points, the consent should be fine. Everything should be really perfect before doing any sort of fertility yes. preservation.
I think it's very clear.
Yep.
I think we have already gone through this. Dr. Priya, you want to add about the counseling has already been covered. Conception, I think this part also, I think the others has covered. Anything more to be added? I think it is quite clear.
Sir, yeah, one thing about Dr. Santosh.
Yeah.
One thing about ovarian tissue cryopreservation and ovarian cancer is not done in most centers because they don't know the ovaries harboring malignancy, okay. You understand? So in, maybe in carcinoma, endometrium, ovary, and cervix, it's okay. But okay. in carcinoma ovary, it is not really advocated because you do not know if it's harboring any malignant cells. Right.
That is very important. Vital point. Not in ovarian cancer, not in cancers where the ovary is likely to be involved, like the CA stomach. And so we have to be very specific. For example, lymphomas are the best cancers. Breast cancer in certain situations, yes, based on the BRCA status. And another thing I would like to add is the role of uterine preservation, especially in 1B tumors. Because later on, this she can conceive with her own uterus. So that is one thing we should always think of. And I always remember my teacher, Dr. Chitradhara, who used to say, in cancer surgery, there is no advantage of removing an organ which is not involved. And in many situations, in ovarian cancers, uterus are usually not involved. Yeah. So I think that is a good advice to keep in mind. Uterus can be preserved in these situations. If it is anything 1C or more, I think that is 1C also in certain situations you can preserve, but beyond that, there is no role for any conservative surgery. So the final HPR in this case is serous cystic adenocarcinoma 1A. Doctor, again, coming back to Dr. Puneet Chandna, you want to add about adjuvant treatment?
Adjuvant treatments, I think, are not, so pre-operative new adjuvants are not considered. Whereas most of the time it is the platinum chemos that we put our bet on post the first line treatment, which is the surgery for all endometrial and all the ovarian.
So basically platinum, cisplatin and paclitaxel,
rubicin and cisplatin.
But don't you think this is a very
in this case
for a serous cyst adenocarcinoma diagnosis? I mean, it's very unusual at 17 years.
No, when we get on to the high grades, that is what we do.
But otherwise, if it is 1A and the nodes are all negative, I think we can leave the patient alone.
Perfect. Yes.
Especially if it is grade 1 and 2 with no node involvement, she can well be left alone. If it is grade 3. If there is grade 3 or if she has an nodal involvement, yes, definitely yes, then the treatment itself.
I think what the ovarian preservation what Puneet was referring to is the kind of drugs that we use in ovarian cancer, in this particular case.
Fine.
Santosh sir, I have a doubt. Because previously we thought about NACT in this case, Neogen chemotherapy in this case. Actually, in this case, we didn't have a biopsy report. All the markers were almost normal. We suspected a germ cell tumor. Finally, our HPR came as serous cystic adenocarcinoma. So what regime did we could have given for her to reduce her tumor size?
Dr. Adarsh, we have to confirm that it is the biopsy proven cases you can give chemo. Yes. You cannot give chemo in a non-biopsy case.
Even in germ cell tumors, if tumor markers are very high, definitely even without biopsy, we can
You cannot give without a biopsy.
In germ cell tumor, if AFP level and all are very high, it is the only situation.
The only situation, Dr. Adarsh, is GTN. Yeah. Only in GTN you can give, not in germ cell tumors.
Germ cell tumors also, if madam AFP level and all very high, we can give it.
In germ cell tumor, yes, we can give chemotherapy if there is a tumor marker which is very high and we have a diagnosis which is pointing towards someone, something. Yes. But in this particular case, if we see, it was not pointing towards a particular diagnosis. So I don't think any medical oncologist would have started a chemotherapy in this case until
without
we do
a biopsy.
It is not a right thing to do.
I think I will make a note. Dr. Shalini, madam, is very right. You have to have a histopathology. But I have given one particular patient. He's a case of germ cell tumor with advanced germ cell tumor. We have done it without a biopsy. That was a very rare situation. But as a rule, if you ask me, I will also be comfortable only after getting a histopathology.
Yes.
So just before closing this case, one question. GnRH agonist therapy. Suppose you have done a salpingogrel in this case and she's going for a chemotherapy because it is she required chemotherapy. In that situation, would you usually give a GnRH agonist therapy? Because we don't usually give it, but this is there. So any personal opinions on that? Any
I think there are some views about it that before starting chemotherapy, if you put the theory is very simple.
Especially in germ cell tumors.
If you put the ovaries into sleep, then the damage to at a long-term side effects are little less. And recovery to receive the normal menses is little earlier as compared to patient who are not given these drugs. But still there is a not a very complete validation. But on gross point, most of the oncologists agree and prefer to do that.
Yes, it can be done, especially in certain, especially I think elderly people, say 30, 35 years, their ovarian reserve is likely to be less. I think there is a valid point in such situations, not maybe in 20, 22 years old girls.
Because their ovarian tissue are as such very, very, you know, a recoverable kind of tissue, but at 35 they are in the almost in the declining age.
Yes, I think I'm going to the last case. I think this is our own case. So this is Mrs. 34-year-old lady. She comes with postcoital bleeding of 6 months later. She has one living child and she wants one more child. So her looks, cervix looks a little hypertrophied, and there's a polyp of it feels hard in the, especially in the anterior lip. Parametrium is free and pap smear shows HCL. She has a cervical polypectomy and biopsy cervix. It gives you this report of CIN3 with microinvasion with LVSI. And MRI was normal. I think, Dr. Santeep, I would request your kind interpretation of these slides. These are our own slides. Dr. Santeep?
What I see in this picture over here is this epithelium is completely replaced by cells which are having very hyperchromatic nuclei, as you can see. And even this tumor is at places extending into this rounded structures which you see below the epithelium. The same kind of hyperchromatic nuclei are there, which is the endocervical gland extension, I believe, in this particular tumor. Since they're very much rounded and clearly defined, not much of desmoplastic response. In this picture, at least, I would not call it a invasion. This is more of a glandular crypt extension. Is there any other picture other than this?
More of a glandular?
Crypt extension. Endocervical
crypt extension. Okay.
Over here, the picture is different. This is a higher magnification, and you can see the same nuclei better. They are same hyperchromatic. The architectural pattern is disoriented, which is indicating it as a high-grade lesion. So this is more like a carcinoma in situ towards the surface. But as you go down, you can see one jagged, there's a lot of dense inflammatory response just below the epithelium. And there is a cluster of cells, which is kind of irregular outlines. So this is probably the focus of invasion, which is there. But it appears to be a very small focus. And I would
Based on this, can we comment that this there is a very clear cut invasion, because I am not very sure about it?
Yes, I can. My pointer won't work because I'm not sharing the screen, but can you bring the pointer right next to the dense inflammation? Yeah. So just, move to the left. This area, more to the right. There is a small island of cells over here within the inflammatory aspect, which is having this irregular outline. This is a small focus, definitely area of invasion. The other ones again appear more like crypt extension.
I don't know. This looks the area. I'm not very sure whether my pointer can be seen. But so according to you, this looks more like an invasion. And it's
very small focus.
Doesn't look like inflammation. It looks like invasion.
So the inflammation is around that focus of invasion, which is a small focus. So it would definitely be more like if this is all.
So basically for us, it is okay. With this, the pathologist, I don't think all the slides we have got. This patient came a couple of years ago. So the slides, the reported was microinvasion with LVSI. That is what we got from the pathologist.
So LVSI is not seen in these pictures.
No. It is not there. It is not the representative image.
So but if other slides,
Other slides, maybe.
So in that particular case, I will come back to Dr. Santeep. Dr. Shalini, madam, what is the treatment options for this patient?
She is I would first do a conization because we're not sure of the invasion. There is invasion in one particular area. Any CIN3 before going in for definitive treatment, I would and this is a young patient too, we would do a conization. And we'll have to address the lymph nodes also because there is LVSI. So conization with either sentinel nodes or with a laparoscopic lymphadenectomy before we can finally decide what we can, what to do for this patient.
What about trachelectomy?
Yeah, after, if the margins of the cone are free and the lymph nodes are negative, that's the treatment itself.
Okay, so
we don't require trachelectomy if margins are free.
Yeah, you don't require trachelectomy if margins are free.
Okay, even with LVSI?
If the lymph nodes are okay, you've done the lymph node dissection.
Because LVSI increases your chances of lymph nodal metastasis. And if we have done our lymph nodal dissection, in that case, we don't really require to address uterus or cervix seriously about it, because that is the completion of the treatment as far as uterus and cervix is concerned. And with the presence of LVSI, we are concentrating more into the lymph nodes, which we have done by doing a laparoscopy.
Dr. Shalini, I have a question, Dr. Shalini. If how much of LVSI would you give import? Even a single focus of LVSI would be enough for you to go for a...
Actually, that has not been addressed, Dr. Mathur. They say microinvasion or 1A1 with LVSI is an indication for a cone and lymph node dissection. That's the current teaching and that's what's done. But we don't talk about a single focus. A single focus of LVSI?
Yeah, some people believe that up to 2 foci, if they are there, you may...
Okay.
Yeah, some young patients...
That's not there in our recommendations anyway.
Yeah, it's not there in the recommendation. But I was wondering any experience you have.
Yeah, Dr. Sandeep, the problem in these cases are that if we miss the bus, we are looking at a more radical kind of treatment.
Okay.
So sometimes doing a laparoscopic pelvic nodal dissection, even with a single LVSI, and a young patient where we are looking for fertility preservation, that appears a more sensible approach rather than waiting and watch.
Agreed to this. Yeah.
So in this particular patient, we were a little more radical because he already has one child, and we went ahead with a vaginal radical trachelectomy. That is my first vaginal radical trachelectomy. And this is the sample, and the final HPR was microinvasion stage 1A1, and actually this was an overtreatment, but the patient. So this is the NCCN guideline. So 1A1 with no LVSI, as Madam very rightly said, cone biopsy with negative margins is the best. No need to do anything more. But with LVSI, or if you are thinking of a larger lesion, say A2. You can, as again said, cone biopsy with negative margins or a radical trachelectomy. So whichever is with, of course, with the pelvic lymph node dissection is a must if there is an LVSI and above. And this patient actually, so this is again, the sentinel node actually can be combined with this. And again, our patient actually didn't wait for, she was very much worried about her cancer scenario, and she opted out for a hysterectomy from outside. Now she didn't come back to us.
But I think that there was no role of hysterectomy in this case. We could have kept this patient under regular observation.
Yes. So.
But patients sometimes are not convinced.
Yeah, I know. I know number of times, because when I see the 3B patient is treated with radical CTRT, they come back to me that हमारे एक doctor ने they did a hysterectomy also.
Oh my God. Okay.
We see this quite often. So,
and it's quite difficult to do it post-radiation. So there are really bold gynecologists who wanted to do it after CTRT.
No. What they do is just they remove the partial, they do a partial hysterectomy.
What is the point in doing
I don't know that. Yeah. Patient satisfaction, I guess. Okay. As far as I am concerned in this particular case, I would be happily referring this patient to one of my colleagues, because giving radiation for CIN3 is totally
absolutely I think we have to be ethical somewhere.
So I think you have already answered this question. We would have actually, in this particular patient, if you are going for a radical radiation, probably if it is stage 2 something like that.
Answer is a big no. This patient doesn't deserve radiation. Finding, no way.
Okay. So ovarian transmission has to be considered if at all you are going for radiation. That's all.
If we are thinking of it, but the problem is in our practice, like I am practicing for so many years, but whenever I see a young lady of 35, 40 and we advise them about ovarian transposition, they are hardly interested in getting ovarian transposition.
Yes,
they say, okay, no, you start the treatment. we will take some hormonal treatment, because gynecologists tell them that taking hormonal treatment is a much a simpler thing. So, or some of their general practitioner advise them that the hormonal treatment is a simpler thing. Ovarian transposition is a surgical procedure.
Okay, so far,
not even a single patient got convinced about ovarian transposition, which in a premenopausal age group, and radical CA cervix treatment. Not even a single patient.
Hopefully, we'll get people. No, people are reading a lot of Google at least. So, I think people will come up.
Gynecologists are winning.
So I think this has become a real tumor board, and the problem with tumor board is
these are the practical things that I'm telling you, because I have a keen interest in CA cervix and we keep all our data. So not even a single patient which is premenopausal and we opted for this radical radiotherapy, we always advise them as a part of the protocol about ovarian transposition. Not even a single patient opted for it.
So I think the real tumor board is like this only. We always debate for the patient, from the patient's point of view, from our point of view, and finally that is we'll try to give the best to our patient. So I think I will end this panel right now, because the time has actually advanced. So yeah. The only message is discretion will protect you and understanding will guard you. You have to keep the advances. This is what Solomon said centuries ago. So we have to keep ourselves abreast of what's a new development is, what we can offer.
And I would just add one more thing, that a teamwork is very, very important.
Yes.
You have to understand your limitation. You can't do everything. So if a patient like this is coming, I won't say, no, I can treat this patient. I may, but that's not right. So some of my colleagues can do a better job than me. So prefer to involve all of them.
And it's difficult to be thorough in your learning and exhaustive in your investigation. Always better to be as a teamwork. Yeah.
So a big thanks to all my panelists.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Great session.
Thank you, Dr. Kunj Mohideen and Dr. Santosh for having us, and Dr. Priya Ganesh too for organizing.
Thank you, everyone. It's a pleasure.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Don't leave. Please switch on all of you. Switch on your video so that. If the guests, everybody, Dr. Faisi, Ashwath. Okay, meanwhile, we will take up some questions.
All right.
Okay. In the questions, the first one, we started getting questions right from the first session. So Dr. Gopinathan from Payyanur, he has asked, and sir was the past president of KFOG. And sir has asked, what strategy FOXI is evolving to vaccinate all our adolescent girls? Question to Dr. Priya.
FOXI is? What is? I didn't get it.
What strategy is evolving to vaccinate all the adolescent
girls? Yeah. So the FOXI is evolving in the multilateral, multidisciplinary aspect. There have been, but then I think... I can't give you one roadmap or something. It has been a multidisciplinary thing involving various organizations and various NGOs. So now I can talk from after when I get it up into the chair, and then let's see how we can evolve. So the main thing is getting the vaccination strategy on. We have to have the leaders. We have to have the the main the. You know, you can say is the main people who are into it are the basically the political backgrounds as well. So we will have to have those and the multimedias, the medias and everyone. So I think now the FOXI has to start thinking on how to make a roadmap and rightly involve the team leaders and the multimedias, the government, and also your institution, teaching institution. That is where we can think about going ahead for vaccination program to be successful.
Okay, along with that, there is one more question. Can the vaccine be given for 26 up to 45 years? That's from Dr. Prabhavan Devi from Vijayawada.
Yes, it can be given. That is what I just mentioned. It is for the catch-up vaccination. They do advise that we can give it till 45 years of age, and but that will be 3 doses scheduled.
Can I add something to that, Dr. Priya?
Yes, please, ahead. Go ahead.
It is an adolescent vaccine, so it's best to give it to young girls and maybe the catch-up to 26 years. And especially now, because there's a global shortage of vaccine. So I think we should conserve it for the people who are younger and who need it most, and offer screening to the older women rather than offer them vaccine. But if they really want it and they say, no, you have to give it to me, that's okay. But I don't think we should go out and give it to older women. We should try to focus on the younger.
That's a more idealistic and more right way of going. But then suppose if they have not taken it and then they are coming to our clinic and they're asking us, okay, madam, about the vaccination, can we also take it up? That's the time when we can't refuse it and we can go ahead giving it. But as rightly said, this cannot replace screening. So because there you're going to more focus on screening. Yeah.
So would it be 11 years or 9 years? Where do we start?
It is usually said it is 9 to 13 years is where we vaccinate before 15 years of age group.
All right.
Okay, the next question is, endometrial thickness cutoff is 7 millimeter in high-risk women like PCOS. Is it correct? Should we have any guideline like that? Santosh or anyone?
4 or 5?
Yeah, please.
Maybe the pick is from the gynecologist, right? Maybe
In a pre-menopausal woman, it is usually taken as 12. Mm-hmm. In a post-menopausal woman, it is 4.
Yeah.
Cut off.
PCOS patients, that was the specific.
There is no difference. If it is pre-menopausal, PCOS also, anything more than 12, we have to sample.
Okay. And is it possible to do endometrial sampling with the LNG IUS in situ?
Yes. We have done that. We are doing it. It is not at all difficult. You can do with in situ LNG ICD, you can do a sampling. It's not difficult. You can.
And even if it comes out, you can put it back in.
That I don't know.
While you're doing the sampling, if it comes out, you can still put it back in.
That will be quite a circus.
No, it's possible.
Okay.
There is one question from Dr. Jitendra. That is 37 years, myomectomy was done, and the histopathology report shows leiomyoma mitotically active, no evidence of malignancy. So what is the pathological significance? I think Dr. Santip can answer.
Yeah, so mitotically active leiomyoma does not meet all the criteria to label it as even a stump or a indeterminate kind of a lesion. So for all practical purposes, it's just like a leiomyoma. So it should be treated like a leiomyoma. Because at best, you can do a more frequent follow-up or something, but I don't think, from pathologist point of view, it is more or less a benign entity.
It's good to have Sandeep with us because he is the one who always cuts the cake and tells this is benign, this is malignant.
Right. You cannot do without the pathologists, right? And they are evolving.
And up to what stage radical trachelectomy can be done in carcinoma cervix?
1B1, that is less than, according to 2018 classification, figure classification 1B1, that is less than 2 centimeter. In the old figure classification, 2009 classification, B1 less than 2 centimeter. That is again the latest classification, B1.
And sir, histology also we should take into account.
Yes, very important. Yes.
Because poorly differentiated histologies, actually we don't prefer to do trachelectomy.
Only squamous cell adenocarcinoma.
Only squamous cell adenocarcinoma.
Yes.
Other varieties like neuroendocrine and all, we don't.
No, not at all.
We can't do that.
And what is the scope of gene therapy in gynec malignancies? I think Dr. Puneet can put it
right. Ovarian gene therapy, precisely, I've been working with the CAR T cell therapies. So CAR T cell therapies, I'm sure Dr. Sandeep would understand. You have receptors on the cells, which are CD, receptors, and these take up. So what we are trying to do is, we are trying to take up the lentiviruses, take the T cells from the body, coat it like a vaccine, live vaccine and spurt it back in. So we have currently on the ALLs, leukemias, and ovarian, it's very promising. Something like, if it works, it may be 50% of the time it may not work, but if it works, it works 100%. Push, it's like one dose and 15 days. So currently, I cannot disclose what kind of ovarians we are working on, but then I can say it is serous and mucinous, which have a straight promise. And following that, you know, under the MET, we have the lung cancer, and the other one, which is more, is multiple myeloma.
So with that, we come to the last part of the session. So thank you all the faculty, the panelists, and all the members for giving a wonderful insight into today's CME on gynecologic oncology. The discussion was with the highest standard and covered almost all the practical points of the various malignancies in gynae. So now I would like to invite Professor Abdul Wahab, who is the past professor and head of the department of ONG at MES Medical College. So over to Dr. Wahab. Dr. Wahab, please.
Hello, everybody. This was a nice CME, a gynecology update today. And thanks to Dr. Ramani Devi, Dr. Ambujam Madam, and Dr. Fessy Lewis and Dr. Ashwath Kumar, who participated actively, and all the panelists of our panel discussion, Dr. Santosh Kuriakos, Ranu Patni, and Dr. Shalini, Dr. Manish Chandra, Dr. Sandeep Mathur, and Dr. Puneet, and to all. It's a nice and wonderful program, and especially CA Cervix is actually really needed some concern because of Oxy is taking up, and I hope Dr. Priya Ganesh, under her leadership, she will take into some other level the screening program and prevention program like vaccination. And thanks to all who participated, except their participation is more than 300-400 logged in and attended this webinar actively. And thanks to all the coordinators and our president, Dr. Kunjumedin, and full team of POCs making this webinar a big success. And thanks to one and all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Dr. Kunjumedin. Thank you, Dr. Abdul Wahab, and KFOGS. Thank you very much, and all the panelists done a very good job.
Yeah. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Santosh.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.